Thank you. We have already called the meeting to order. We had an executive session starting at 6 o'clock. All council members are present except for Jerry Sims is not here tonight. We'll start out with announcements. I'll start, there are a couple. This weekend, this Saturday, from starting at 11 o'clock in the morning and ending at 10 o'clock at night, is a new event called Springs Fest. It's a music festival, and it will be here at the Bryan Center. And Yellow Springs Brewery will be having, we'll have Yellow Springs Brewery beer and lots of, this is of a generation of music that's younger than me, so I don't know them, but I understand that there are some great performers and that people are very excited about it. So please come out for that. And also next Tuesday, the 12th, at 5:30, Dayton Mailing Service, or now known as DMS Inc., will be having an open house and a ribbon cutting at 5:30. Brian, did you have anything?
I do. All right, so first of all, I wanted to thank everybody that was involved in a great 4th of July Day celebration. And that would be, of course, our local chapter of the Odd Fellows, who sponsored both the parade and the fireworks. It was great that both of those came off. And also, I want to thank Chief Altman and our Miami Township Fire and Rescue, as well as our village team, which always does a lot of work for the event. And the second thing I wanted to mention is the John Bryan Community Pottery. This Friday is kicking off their Kickstarter for, what's the kiln called? It's to replace the reduction kiln. So I know they'd like to see people turn out for that Friday early evening.
I think there's going to be food, music, and entertainment for that, too.
Yeah.
Mary Ann and Judith, any announcements? Patty?
We've been talking for some time about dedicating the wastewater treatment plant in memory of John Eastman. We do have a tentative date for that, which is August the 10th. If everyone would please check their calendars and let us know if that is a good or a bad day. We're thinking probably sometime around 1 in the afternoon.
And we'll let Terry know?
She's the one that picked the date.
Oh, good. Okay, good. Okay. Next, we have an item on the in announcements that is typically would be probably something within the agenda, but timing required that it go in the announcement section. We are here to get an update from Community Resources. I see Sarah Wildman is here for that, so I will ask Sarah to come up to the podium.
Council, thank you very much. I'm Sarah Wildman. I'm here representing Community Resources. I am presently the secretary for the Community Resources Board. And we've had several meetings recently, when we've been trying to determine exactly how we should, what we should do and how we should move ahead and what's best for the community. And so we have decided that we want to transfer the property that we presently own, known as the Center for Business and Education. We want to transfer that to the village. And so it is our intent to work with the village attorney to make that happen. And what I have given you this evening is an appraisal that we had done by Sheridan. Matt Sheridan did the appraisal, Sheridan Associates. And that will be for you all to review. And hopefully we can affect that transfer pretty efficiently and effectively. And we're looking forward to working with each of you, all of you, and with your village attorney. And if there's anything that I can do to help facilitate that along the way, I'd be glad to do that. So just let me know. That's really all I have tonight.
That's a lot.
It's a lot.
That's a lot.
It's a pretty big deal. And
it is.
But we're very excited about that and think that it's the right time for the village to take over that property and move ahead with projects and explore opportunities that we have been unable to explore or affect. So We're very excited about it.
You know, there's probably a lot for us to talk about. I think what I will suggest is that we actually add a discussion item in new business about what steps the village, you know, what the village responds, how the village will handle this. So, Chris, just keep that in your mind for when we get to new business, and we'll do that during agenda planning. Thank you. I mean, it's great to see you. It's great to hear from Community Resources. We really appreciate all the work that's been done over the long number of years you have been working on this project, and we know that your hearts and your souls were put into this, and we appreciate the sentiment and feeling towards the property coming back to the village.
Great. Yeah, we're very excited about that and think that there are great things ahead, and that this is the right time. If there's anything I can do or help or questions eventually that I can answer, I'd be glad to work with all of you, each of you, whatever.
Thanks, Sarah.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, Sarah. And I'd like to thank you. I was actually a founding board member of Community Resources. And I know that a lot of people have put a lot of work into it, volunteer work, and that it's also very difficult to be in a community when an issue like this becomes so divisive, mm-hmm. as this did. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I would just like to express to everyone who has worked on it and everyone currently my gratitude to mm-hmm. be willing to do something, yeah. even when it's unpopular and yeah. you have to take a lot of heat.
Well, and as you know, Marianne, that the popularity has kind of waxed and waned for Community Resources and the things that Community Resources was trying to do. And you know, the wind blows and shifts, and that's the way life is. But there have been, over the years, over I think 13 or 14 years, a great many people in Yellow Springs who have served diligently on that committee and tirelessly, and some were thanked appropriately and some probably were not, but I think everyone who did serve on that committee, on that organization, felt very strongly about it and worked hard and with only the best intentions in mind for the village. And so, yeah, there are a number of people, and they all deserve to be thanked. And we are trying to do that as the remaining board members. We're trying to take care of that and make sure everybody's a part of the, feels in some way a part of the process. So,
I wanted to say too, because I was the, is this on?
Excuse me.
I was the liaison from council for mm-hmm. some period the last time I was on council. Mm-hmm. And the motivation of the people on Community Resources was a concern for the village economy. Mm-hmm. And so I think, yeah, I think it was, it did become a difficult board to perhaps serve on, but definitely the reason that people were on that board was their care for the village.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And so just people need to keep that in mind, mm-hmm. No matter where they stood on
the effort. Yeah, that's all in the past now, and I think we all feel that way, and just looking forward to a new path forward and being able to participate in that and, like I said, help in any way that we can.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Our best wishes to everyone.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is our consent agenda. All that we have in it are the minutes of, excuse me, the minutes of the June 20th meeting. Can I get a motion for approval?
I move.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay. Next is a review of the agenda. As I just asked, we will put an item in under new business regarding the CBE property. Anything else?
I think we should also add the request from Arts and Culture Commission, whether we decide on it tonight.
To new business?
Yeah. I think we should at least briefly discuss it.
Any other changes? Do you want to review the petitions and communications?
Yes. Okay, so we had several things that were in the packet, some new things that came in the last 24 hours that are on the table. So I'll reference all of them. We had a, actually, I think it's a editorial, a letter to the editor that's going to be in the YS News from David Wishart, and that is related to Morris Bean and whether this is a good precedent. Kate Anderson also submitted something taking issue with a letter that was submitted. Beth Bridgman had a letter about policing related to Antioch College. Laura Curlis submitted a letter in opposition to extending a sewer tap to Morris Bean, and unless there's annexation. Bob Barkus wrote about street musicians, which he loves, but he would like us to revisit the idea of whether amplified recorded music should be allowed. The current street musician agreement restricts amount of time in a certain spot. We had some information from MVRPC, Miami Valley Regional Planning Commission, very interesting. One of those being their additional online web maps and resources that are interactive. And secondly, they have done a regional profile series that talks about things like diversity in our region, and this was updated up to 2015. And then finally, the Yellow Springs Police Department got a thank you from Green Cats for participating in the Street Smarts crosswalk training. And this is also an announcement. Green Cats is going to be celebrating 15 years. And on July 28th, they are going to have a public celebration from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. out at the Green County Media Room, which is on Ledbetter Road. Okay.
Thank you. Next on the agenda is public hearings and legislation. We have the second reading and public hearing of ordinance 2016-13. Judy can read this in by title only.
Yes, this is approving sanitary sewer connection agreement with Morris Bean and Company and authorizing the village manager to enter into the amended sanitary sewer connection agreement.
I'm changed my mind. Could you just read it in full? Thank
yes.
you.
Whereas beginning in the early 1990s, environmental concerns have been expressed in regard to Morris Bean and Company's MBC package plant because it sits atop the village of Yellow Springs' well field. And whereas historically previous village councils and the Ohio EPA have supported MBC's desire to connect to the village's sanitary sewer system to protect the well field. And whereas a connection to the village's sanitary sewer system is consistent with the current and soon to be amended wellhead protection management plan. And whereas a connection to the village's sanitary sewer by MBC would mitigate a potential hazard to the wellhead. And whereas the Village Council has determined that it would be in the best interest of the Village to allow MBC to connect to the Village's sanitary sewer system to alleviate the environmental concerns and approves the amended sanitary sewer connection agreement. Now, therefore, Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, hereby ordains that. Section 1, Council hereby approves the amended sanitary sewer connection agreement with Morris Bean and Company in a form substantially similar to the agreement attached hereto as Exhibit A. Section 2, Council authorizes the village manager to enter into the amended sanitary sewer connection agreement with Morris Bean and Company in a form, the correct section 2 should be this ordinance shall take effect and be in full force with the earliest date permitted by law.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. I think we'll just turn this over to legal counsel.
Good evening, everybody. I've had an opportunity to discuss this with Mr. McCready, Morris Bean's counsel, and based upon those discussions, Mr. McCready and I, and I'm making this request primarily on his behalf as well, but asked the council consider tabling the ordinance for the moment. Mr. McCready and I would like to further clarify the scope of the agreement as set forth in 1A. Which currently says resulting from the use of property for commercial, industrial, or agricultural purposes. We want to talk a little bit more about that, and so it's really not ripe for council's approval as a final ordinance at this time.
Okay. Can I get a motion to table?
So move.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. I would like to suggest, though, that we hear from citizens who came to speak to this, that we hear that input. I don't know if it should be at Citizens Concerns or now, but since, you know, partly we were hoping to have a little more time for discussion. Now we're getting a little more time, so we don't, I see there's people here who I'm sure are here to speak to this. It'd be good to hear their input.
Yeah, we'll take a little bit of time at this point for that. But also encourage them to actually come to the next meeting, because that's the public hearing and about that issue. So, Chris, what's your
there are people here who wanted to discuss the issue. Now would be the appropriate time,
okay,
since there was an expectation that the ordinance would be approved and that opportunity would exist.
Okay.
Can I have a process question?
Sure.
Does the council also speak on this? Given that we've tabled it,
we can speak. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, we should talk. You're not going to vote to approve anything, but appropriate to share your feelings.
Okay. So can council go first?
Go ahead.
Okay. So I don't have 100% of the information about this, but it's my understanding that Morris Bean is a company that was started by Morris Bean and his wife, I think, Rodney Bean's parents. When they were Antioch students, they developed a process. The property is just south of Yellow Springs. It has never been annexed to Yellow Springs. And yet, it has been an important industry, I think, located outside of Yellow Springs. Over the past 10 or 15, I'm not sure how long, the relationship has maybe been a little bit rocky, I think. It's my opinion that we're best served by having strong relationships with our local businesses and industries. And so to the extent that we can do that, I support that. There we've gotten a couple letters about negative about the industry, characterizing it as a polluting industry. And what I'd like to say is that I don't think there's anyone in this room who's not polluting. And if there is, I'd like to see that person. We're embedded in a system where that's what's happening. And from my point of view, the more we can work together for environmental purposes and economic development purposes and everything else, the better. And so, to the degree that I can support this, I want to do that.
Thanks, Mary Ann.
I want to wait.
Okay. I also would like to say, in relation to documents that were in the packet, to just recognize that we're legally required to put those in the packet, and in no way reflects the feelings of this council, and hopefully not the community. So, it was unfortunate, and I don't want to. I love what Mary Ann said, and have the exact same feelings. So, people that were here to speak to that issue, Dave, I see you're here. Would you?
Yeah. So I have a question for the representatives.
Can you speak to the chair?
Oh, sure.
And
I have a question for the representatives.
State your name, please.
David Wisher.
Okay.
I'm curious to know how much construction of the wastewater or the waste facility by Morris Bean would cost. How much, in effect, are they saving by tapping into our sewer system? Could anyone answer that?
I don't know that we know that. I don't know that that is a factor in the decision making.
I mean, one thing that has been discussed is that this will be a more costly option to tap into the village, and that was discussed at our first meeting.
More costly
for Morris Bean. Yeah, because they're responsible for building all of the infrastructure
and paying for it,
and they'll pay double.
Yeah, 100% surcharge on the fees.
So I teach economics. This flies in the face of everything I understand about the way companies operate. Companies want to do the profit maximizing thing. Why wouldn't they go ahead and build their own treatment facility if it's more expensive to tap into our sewer system?
Well, the EPA, I guess they would have to answer that question, but the EPA has recommended that to the village and to Morris Bean that they tap into our sewer system.
But it's impossible to give a figure as to exactly what the cost of construction of the facility would be.
Yeah, we're here to answer any questions the council has, and we would be glad to do that at the next meeting if you'd like us to.
Okay, thank you.
That seems like an important bit of information.
We'll decide. I think that for me personally, I don't know that that has a factor. I mean, I think we have to look at what this is for the village. I mean, what this means for the village, not necessarily how much it's going to cost them. It's, you know, it's a different equation to me. It's,
well, I think that the health and well-being of Morris Bean is of some concern to the village, isn't it?
Certainly. Marcia, are you done, Dave?
Can I suggest a process that we kind of get here from all the citizens,
right,
and gather any questions and then figure out what to do with the questions afterwards? Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, my name is Marcia Walgren. It came to my attention that the Greene County Public Health Commissioner, in his report of May 27th, 2016, basically there was a citizen complaint, and it was found that the sewer system that they currently have had completely failed and was fouling a stream on someone's property. And both the EPA and the health department were called in. I have a link to that, which I can get to you, from the Greene County Health Department. At the time, OEPA inspected it and basically said the best course of action would be installation of a replacement system. And the company said they would be installing a new mound system. Now, Morris Bean also has an NPDES permit, which is Ohio Environmental Protection Agency, authorizing to discharge under the National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System. What's odd to me is that in September 2012, their permit began, which is to expire August 13th, 2017, and it was conditional on Morris Bean abandoning their sanitary wastewater treatment plant and constructing sewer lines that flow into the village. And they had no later than 54 months to do so. And we had already said that we were not going to do that at the time. In addition, they are currently under violations for an inspection they had where their foundry was discharging into a sinkhole. This is industrial waste. There's an issue with that, whether that can be fixed. That is considered a threat to the well field by OEPA, as well as this failed sewer system that is currently ongoing. Back when they tried to do this before, Laura Curlis had said that to extend utilities beyond the borders without annexing violates a policy that goes back to 1992, and even with 100% surcharge in utility fees, that this would not recoup the village's costs. So, I mean, if we're doing a favor to both ourselves to protect the well field and the company, it seems to me that they should pay for it. And I'm also concerned with the environmental violations that do go back to this original 1990 article where they fouled our well. We lost a village well, and to this day we still have dichloroethylene that is detectable. It's below detection limits. Detection limits do not mean safe limits, they mean what can be detected at, but that is still appearing in well 1 and 2.
You're at 3 minutes.
We have basically ongoing environmental problems, and I'm considering that water is our most precious resource and we have an abundant supply and we need to protect it, I would like to see that we have some power to make sure that it is protected. So I would like to see any kind of, if you can't annex, I'd like to know why they can't annex. I guess one good question would be why.
Marcia, your time's up.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
Judy Parker, Yellow Springs. I have a somewhat different concern, and that is for the effect of the compound called Zyglo coming out of the sewer plant. Sewer plants usually treat waste, human waste, not necessarily chemical. I understand they're allowed to send out 600 gallons a day Zyglo rinse water, whatever that means. To me, Zyglo sounds like a fluorescent compound, and those are compounds used by science and industry because they have huge effects for tiny, tiny amounts. So they absorb energy, then they give off light. Maybe it's not a fluorescent compound, but I think it is. We need to find out. So this might also be the same compound that they were once before asked not to use anymore because it was leaving the grounds of the plant. So what I would like to know is how much Zyglo will leave the sewer plant without being broken down. Will we see it? Will it glow? What kind of effect would it have on the plants and animals in the glen? Would we have to modify our sewer plant in order to break it down in some way? Or could they break it down? Those are my concerns because I know these compounds are fairly new in our use of things and we should find out about them. Make sure we know what we're doing. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
We're speaking about Morris Bean?
Yes.
Just in time then.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Use this?
Yes, please, and state your name.
No problem. My name is George Beery. I grew up in Yellow Springs. I've lived in the Vail community for 30 years. And I'm the land manager of Glen Helen, so Morris Bean is my neighbor on two counts, the Glen and the Vale. I have pretty strong feelings about Morris Bean. I feel they've dragged their feet on a number of issues that involve pollution and contamination to my community, the Wellfield, and the Glen. I don't know whether you know that Morris Bean, who was, in my opinion, a patriarch, set up the water lease for Morris Bean in the Glen in 1945, and they would draw 1/8 of the village's use of water directly from the aquifer every day, I believe. It's a lot. And so all that water gets recircled, circulated, goes out through the pond, and supposedly it goes back down through the Glen. So that's just one piece. Now, in terms of this annexation issue, I think that originally they were going to do something in 2010, and I don't know who's got the blame, whether council changed or whatever, but they did not follow through with that plan, which was a tap-in, a 3-inch pipe that nobody else could use. It would tap into the village on Spillane. That did not happen. So I feel like they've dragged their feet ever since that time. Now, one of my neighbors was alarmed at the algal bloom in our creek, which is shared by Morris Bean, that ends up in the Little Miami River. And he was the one who got alerted the health department to the fact that their system has failed. It is a failed system. I don't know whether you got that in your packet or not. So I think at this point in time that you should not annex Morris Bean. You should let them build their mound system, which is going to be expensive and it will be very sensitive, and it will respond to whatever they do. And that's my feeling. You should not annex, you should not set that precedent. By the way, destroying precedent doubled my water in the township, and apparently it still doesn't cover the cost. So it's my understanding that Morris Bean will not annexing to them and will, their taxes, and they will not cover the cost of the village to that burden. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
My name is Lee Huntington. I haven't made up my mind whether I'm for or against the annexation. My sense is that the council has not done due diligence. I have seen nothing about a cost analysis. I don't know how much you expect to receive from Morris Bean, how much water is going to go into the system. the cost of the wastewater plant to add the ability to distill these pollutants out or treat them. What is the effect on the wastewater treatment plant as far as its life cycle goes? Is this going to speed up the need to replace it or enlarge it? And so I would hope that before you would make that kind of, the kind of decision you're talking about, that you would look at the effect on the village and all the people who live in it as far as sustaining the cost to the plant and make sure that Morris Bean carries its fair share if that's necessary. Thank you.
Thank you. And just to clarify, because two people have said it, we're not talking about annexing Morris Bean. That's actually not part of this discussion.
That will be part of the discussion when
no,
you...
It's not. The legislation is to extend a sewer line to them without annexation. So annexation isn't being discussed or considered.
For them to come to us, we're not extending the line to them.
So the discussion is...
About a sewer line.
Do you extend a sewer line to them?
Well, they would...
Or do they build their own?
They would build their own line and come to
their
the village.
Right.
Okay, but all my questions about cost analysis and due diligence...
Right, we'll talk about that.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll talk
okay.
about that.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bob, I saw your hand.
While the topic tonight requires careful, serious reflection, it is not rocket science. We have two things to decide. The first one is we want to safeguard our Yellow Springs water supply. That is the primary thing of a two-prong attack. This council has already decided that. We didn't want our water from Springfield. We had good information that the Tremont City landfill with our 5,055-gallon drums of waste material, the plume was heading our way. And this council correctly decided Yellow Springs has to determine their own destiny for water. Okay. That may take some doing. The second thing is, while we're talking about the economic benefits, are there any? We need to talk about economic benefits, because I've talked to some people the last week that say, Bob, my water bill is going to double every year for 3 years, and rightly so. Your budget requires it. We have a water treatment plant that's gone from 1.8 million to 3-something to 5-something, now it's 7-something, and nobody can say this is what it's going to be. But I believe we want to control our own water system. Mobeen has to participate in the financing of whatever our costs are, and to do it, you've got to annex them. We've got to have the people pay city tax. They pay school tax already, so that won't change. City income tax, they'll have to pay it. It might have some economic implications, but it does every entity that has to pay it. Why should Mobeen escape it? They've had a free ride for a long time. That big mound of chalk out there, and Lord knows what happened to it. But this has to be contemplated. I think we've definitely got to take the steps to guarantee our own supply. And on the economic thing, thank God we've got a hotel. We lost 285 jobs at Vernet, 110, 115 jobs at Antioch Publishing. YSI has transferred two divisions to Beaver Creek and to the south. Morris Bean went from 450 when I was cooking cheeseburgers at Village Lanes for 15 years, and now they're down, I would guess, to 225. They closed the Cedarville plant. 300 jobs disappeared. So a lot of good jobs have gone. I'm not saying council is broke because they've managed their money well, but annexation ought to be considered for our economic survival. Thank you.
Thanks, Bob. Carol, you had your hand up.
I think the book case people probably, just a couple of things real quickly, because I'm more confused than when I came in. Carol Cobb, Yellow Springs.
I've got a late start on understanding about what was going on at Morris Bean, because I haven't been keeping up with the papers, our wonderful paper in town. But my thing is also, how is it going to benefit us? Just seems like in the past several years, maybe longer, that a lot of things that are happening don't benefit the village people. But yet everything else seems to be going up, which is the way of the world now. So when you're giving something away, I want to know, what are we going to get in return? I wasn't aware of what this gentleman brought up. I do remember hearing things as he was going over them about the problems in the past with Morris Bean, and that's very worrisome, because if we had those kind of problems, are we going to have that going forward with them if they haven't done what they should have in the past? So I would just like a more comprehensive understanding, and maybe it's somewhere on the internet that I need to be looking, about what is going in, what they want to do, how much is it going to cost, and who is it going to cost. So I don't know if you all can provide that, or you have and I've just missed out on it. So maybe somebody could answer that, and then I'm done.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Carol. Anyone else? Okay. First of all, it's not going to cost the village anything. Morris Bean is doing this proposal, and I am only going to speak to the proposal that's on the table. They are paying to extend the line to us. They are doing all of the work. They will tie into our system. We will have no expense. They will be paying double the rate because they are outside the village. They will be paying double the rate. Does that equal what income tax from 225 people would be? Probably not. But we're not losing money. I mean, I will turn this over to Patty in just a second to address some of the questions related to the system. You know, and why are we doing it? We are doing it. My decision is based upon protecting our water system. It is to protect our groundwater system. And the situation of them dragging their feet, we were the ones that pulled the plug. The village pulled the plug on them connecting into our system back in 2012. So it wasn't Morris Bean dragging their feet. It was us pulling the plug on that decision. I'm trying to see what other questions. The effect of the Zyglo, that I will turn to Patty, and also, there were questions about the capacity of our system and what it might do to our system in the future and current capacity. So I'll let you answer those.
First of all, Zyglo is a fluorescent. I have spoken with Brad Ald, who is our superintendent of wastewater treatment. He tells me it does not require any pretreatment either on Morris Bean's part or on our part. The flow that will be coming into the village that we, Larry and I have been talking about, is about 2,600 gallons a day based on 90 employees, because they normally have anywhere between 80 and 100 is what they currently have, not 225. So it's about 2,600 gallons a day. That's 25 gallons per person at 90 people, plus the 600 of Zyglo. That will not greatly in any way, shape, or form speed up the deterioration of our plant. It's easily handled by what we have in place.
I mean, our plant is, with the renovation, with the redo of the plant,
correct.
Our plant is potentially has plenty of capacity.
Yes, it does.
Okay.
Karen,
can I say
sure.
something?
Yeah.
So I just wanted to say, I've been a little bit struggling with this to feel I was, you know, fully informed, but here's a couple of things I wanted to share. One is, as Marcia said, water is our most precious resource. I think many people feel that. And the problem with so we would love to see Morris Bean annexed, but we don't get to decide that. They have to decide that. And if they decide, and they have not decided they wanted to annex, they've decided, you know, that they want to hook into the system, but stay outside of the village. So the choices that we have, you know, we'd love to see them annexed, but that's not our choice. If they do their own package plant, it will be done on top of our wellhead. And if they hook into our system, it will, a pipe will take it to our wastewater treatment plant, which is not on top of our wellhead. So in terms of protecting the wellhead, I mean, a new package plant presumably would be very clean and would not endanger our wellhead. But nonetheless, the idea of, you know, a sewer plant over the wellhead, you know, is one of concern for anybody and any environmentalist, because things can happen. In terms of the annex, one concern I've had, probably the main concern I've had, is would it set a precedent? Nothing really about Morris Bean, but would it somehow force the village then to provide utilities to other folks outside the village? When, you know, the thing that's in the best interest of all citizens, of all villagers, in terms of us being able to support ourselves as a community, is for annexation to be part of the deal when you're providing utilities. But I think, I mean, from what I know now, I feel a little more reassured that that would not happen. Part of the reason we tabled this issue tonight is because of some of the language. We would like the, for the agreement that if anything major changed out at Morris Bean, they sold it, it became something different out there, that it would trigger annexation, that would, because that will help the village financially. And so, you know, we would like to see that happen. We would welcome Morris Bean to annex, that would help all of us as, you know, taxpayers, but that's not a choice that we get to make. And did I say all of that correctly? That's what I'm understanding.
Yep. I just wanted to briefly speak to due diligence. I understand a lot of folks are, this is the first meeting that they've attended or are really seeing what we're talking about. But for us, this is the third meeting that we've dug deep into this. And Morris Bean gave a very detailed presentation, not to mention that our village team has even more information. I think the only number that I haven't heard actually stated at council meetings was the gallons per day. And Patty, based on that, what would be, what kind of revenue are we talking about?
We are talking about, you want it monthly or annually?
I guess monthly.
Approximately $1,445 per month.
Okay. But, you know, I do want to emphasize that we have been discussing what is IGLO. We've been discussing with our village staff about how those impacts are. Not that those questions shouldn't be continued to be answered so everybody's informed, but we have been working very diligently on this.
Well, and to also say part of the, I was a little upset. I don't like to get legislation that we don't have any time to discuss it. We have to hurry up. Well, part of the reason is because Morris Bean has been told by the EPA they need to move forward, and they need to move forward now. So they need an answer. I mean, that's reassuring in a lot of ways, because it means, you know, this is going to get addressed, and it needs to be addressed quickly. And so it's either going to be coming in onto the village system or building their own plant. They've got a deadline. They have got to move forward. Given what George is saying, you know, about, you know, some of the leakage into this stream, we want it to be addressed quickly. So on one hand, I didn't like the time pressure of, you know, we don't have a lot of time to sort of make sure we know everything that we want to know. On the other hand, the reason there's that pressure is for a good reason, because they need to move forward, they agree that they're going to move forward, and they want to figure out what's their best alternative.
I mean, this is complex, and it has a long history, and it is my understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, that the village signed an agreement in, for annexation in 2010.
Not for annexation, for extension.
I mean, I'm sorry, tapping into the sewer, that we signed an agreement, and there was some money that was going to be available that fell out, federal money. So the delay is probably at least as much on part of the village, and there is this, what we're trying to do now is make an agreement that's as tight as possible so that we can handle the sewage from Morris Bean, but we don't set a precedent, as Judith was saying, to incur, to have this happen.
Patty, was there something?
Yes, there was one other thing I wanted to address, and I'm not sure if George brought it up or perhaps Marcia, about the effluent from the discharge channel at the back end of the property and the compounds that are currently being found. And I think it's important to keep the two things separate, because what we're talking about is the sanitary sewer and the Zyglo versus the discharge process water. And I think that maybe some people here don't understand that Morris Bean has made an improvement back there in that discharge channel to prevent the sinkholes from happening, and therefore to prevent that process water from going down into the groundwater without the proper percolation that is required. Is that correct, Larry? So I think that's I think it's important to keep those two things separate, but to understand that Morris Bean has made the effort to do that.
Do either of you want to say anything, or you just want to wait till the next meeting?
Yeah, no, since the matter has been tabled,
okay.
I think it would be best if the village has questions either through Patty or through council,
okay.
That we will certainly try to answer those questions between now and the next meeting, and answer any other questions you have at the next
okay.
meeting. That's okay.
That's great. That's right. Perfect. I just wanted to give you the opportunity.
You.
And Patty, if for the next meeting, mm-hmm. could we compile everything mm-hmm. we've had given to us about this so that citizens can see the whole package?
Would it make sense to say a little bit more about the discharge, the effluent from their process
yeah.
that's not going to be tapping into our sewer?
Well, they have an NPEDS permit through the Ohio EPA for that, and they're required to regularly test. Is it quarterly?
Monthly.
Monthly
and quarterly.
Okay. And that is the discharge process water from everything. It's except the Zyglo. It's all the other process water, and it's combined with their stormwater runoff. And that's it, right? There's nothing else in that mix.
It's non-contact cooling water.
Non-contact cooling water. So.
Okay.
You have another hand.
Oh. Sylvia,
I would like to.
Can you come up to the microphone, please?
Sure.
And state your name, please.
Sure. I'm Sylvia Carter-Miller. I think all the pressure is coming now from what happened at Flint. I think Morris Bean is really wanting to get themselves out of any kind of would-be problem. And I'm very concerned about the fox tending the chicken house, as that said. When you go and test waters, I'd like to have impartial, somebody else testing the water rather than they. I'd like to hear a good report on that. I want to know what's going on there. So that's my thing.
I believe we have EPA.
I don't have EPA.
Well, great.
Well, the way the EPA permits work, everyone tests their own water. They take the sample, send it out to an independent lab, and those lab reports are provided to the EPA.
Yeah, Dan?
Dan Kerrigan. I think Dave Wishart's point is very important, that we should get a figure from Morris Bean how much their own water waste disposal facility would cost, because we need to have some transparency about that. I understand the Damocles, you know, sword hung over us, the damage to our water. Can you answer me why you said that you're going to charge twice as much as the going rate?
Because that's our policy.
Your policy?
That's the ordinance.
That's
okay.
The current ordinance.
Why not? Are we basically giving away the water? Twice as much?
Water outside the village is charged at 150% of the inside the village, and sewer outside the village is charged at 200% of the cost to someone inside the village. That's how the ordinance reads.
Okay. That's the ordinance that you're writing right now?
No, that's the ordinance that's been in effect for quite some time.
Okay. I still think because we're not annexing the product, the property, that we should consider whether or not that's a really fair price. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to move on to the next. So, Patty, you're prepared? Okay. Move on to the next piece of legislation. Second reading and public hearing of ordinance 2016-14 that is currently tabled. So I guess what we need to know is if there is a motion to untable this particular ordinance, if we want to keep it tabled. So we don't have a motion, so we'll keep that one tabled. Okay, then we'll go to resolution 2016-34.
Title only or in full?
Title only.
All right, this is approving the finance director's 2017 tax budget for the Village of Yellow Springs.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Melissa?
Okay, what you have before you is our first look at the 2017 budget. Essentially, what the tax budget does is the county sends us rates for property taxes for the year 2017. I then incorporate those rates into our budget, and I provide them with a full budget projection of 2017 so that then can be turned back to them so that they can take a look at it and determine whether or not we are worthy of all of our property tax dollars in which they are projecting will be assessed in the year that we are looking at, which is 2017. So what I did was I took the rates that they gave us and incorporated them into the tax budget. And the tax budget is actually a 9-page document. Only 7 of those are filled out, but the other two, pages 8 and 9, are included in, just so it doesn't look like I skipped something. So we'll go through this page by page, just so that I can explain what we're looking at. The first page is for the general fund, and this is revenues. And it breaks down all of the revenues for the general fund, and it also includes the property taxes in which the county auditor have given us in which to incorporate. So at the estimated revenues for 2017 are $3.1 million, so $3,100,825. And basically all of these revenues, the revenues are basically the most important part of this, because this will be used as our first estimated resources once we submit the budget in the fall for January 1st, 2017. So general fund revenues are outlined on the first page. If we skip to the second page, we start to get into general fund expenditures. And the only part that's extrapolated out are the police department's figures. And included in this, just like the revenues, which I should have probably previously stated, it also shows our 2014 and 2015 actuals, as well as our estimations for 2016 after the end of May, or as of the end of May. And then it also gives our estimations for 2017. So page 2 shows our police department figures. If we skip to page 3, this lumps together all of our other departments.
Questions?
Mm-hmm.
What accounts for the jump between 16 and 17 under contractual services? That's page 2.
I've got the detail here. I can take a look at that. Most of the time, when I do the projections, I'm very conservative about that. Mm-hmm. So our budget for 2016 was likely much higher than what our projections are. And as of the end of May, as are all of the budget figures, they're coming in lower than what we're actually budgeted. So if I take a look at the police department.
Part of it, I'm sure, is the phone calls.
The contractual services were actually budgeted for the year at $134,000. So if we take a look at the projections.
It's $141,000.
Well, for current year, if we look at current year, $1 million, or I'm sorry, for contractual services, let me see, $119,000. So the actual budget was $134,000. So then if we look at what's budgeted, it's just $6,000 more than what was actually budgeted in 2016. So it's not a significant increase.
So you're basing the 2017 budget on the 2016 budget or 2016
yes.
actuals? 2016?
2016 budget in okay. a lot of ways, because since there's only 5 months under our belt with the projections, I try to be a little conservative with the budget for 2017. Does that answer your question,
yes.
Mary Ann? Okay.
Melissa, before we move, back on page one,
mm-hmm.
it's not significant, but I'm just curious about the liquor and beer permits, why that is less than half. What does that reflect, or what's that about?
Those only come in twice a year, mm-hmm. and so the second half of 2016 could be a little bit more than what
okay.
the first half was. So I was just going by what we had already received. I would have to look, because most of the time it's pretty evenly distributed, but that could be one where it's a little heavier on the second half of the year when we receive the second half of those.
Okay. And then services miscellaneous. What is miscellaneous?
In the revenues?
Yeah.
Let's see. That includes a lot of different things. The property sales from Cemetery Street were in there, so that's kind of something that can't be budgeted for, because we don't know whenever we're going to sell property and where those dollars are going to go. So that drove up 2016.
Mm-hmm.
So property sales are in there. Any interest that we receive, any rent that we receive from any of the cell towers and such go into that. Any reimbursements we might receive, the cable franchise comes into that.
Okay.
So it's kind of a catch-all.
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay, so page three will show our expenditures. So this is everything else, not including the police department, which are included in a general government. However, the totals do take into consideration the police department if we scroll down to the very bottom. And this actually has our fund balance estimations. And I will point out that by the end of 2017, we're projected to have a surplus of just a little over $2 million, which is really good. And I'm going to circle back around to those fund balance projections to a secondary document that I created outside of this. Once we go through these pages, the transfers that I included with the expenditures for 2017, I did not include any transfers out to any of the capital improvement funds, just for this discussion, so that we had a pretty basic look at what our actual costs were going to be without any kind of discretionary spending or transfers out to those funds, which we had started to do in 2016, so that we get a pretty firm look at where we are. Just with our actual costs. If we skip to page four, this outlines our police pension fund. Basically, all of our full-time police officers, their retirement has to come out of a separate fund. So this is outlining those costs for 2017. They're pretty standard, though. They hover right around $100,000 for the year for those full-time officers. If we skip to page five, this outlines all of our special revenue funds. And this form is slightly different than the ones that we were just looking at. It starts with our estimated unencumbered fund balances as of January 1st, 2017. And then the next column is our receipts. And then the unencumbered balance and the receipts is totaled up for the total available for expenditures in that third column. And then our expenditures are listed out in the next two columns and then totaled up. And then the very last column is our estimated unencumbered fund balance for the end of 2017. So the top half is our special revenue funds, and then the bottom half are our capital project funds. So then we'll go ahead and we will skip to page six. This includes all of our enterprise funds. Again, it's laid out the same as what our special revenue funds and the capital project funds were. So we've got all of our enterprise funds, and then we've got some smaller accounts which include the inactive payroll account. We used to have a separate fund for that ages ago, which we haven't since I've been finance director. And then we also have trust and agency funds like our widows fund, our guaranteed deposits fund, mayor's court, things like that, which are in and outs, relatively small.
Can we transfer that old payroll account into another payroll line to, just to clean that up?
I need to look to see what the restrictions are on that and what the source of those funds were. I'm sure that they came from the general fund, so that's definitely something that I can look into because it's just laid dormant for quite some time now. And if we skip to page 7, these are the capital improvements that were incorporated into the 2017 budget. There are just a few things in here, a new police cruiser out of the general fund, and then out of the electric capital improvement fund, an infrared camera, power pole changeout, and then facilities improvement fund, some Bryan Center renovations. So those total $165,000. Then the last two pages are just blank, which I include so that it doesn't look like I missed something in submitting the tax budget. Also in the packet, which I'll draw your attention to, is a pretty important sheet that shows the history of our major fund balances. What I did was I took the general fund, the electric, the water, the sewer, and the solid waste funds, which are our major funds that we work with each year. And I've got in there the beginning and ending balances back from 2010 all the way through where I project we will be at the end of 2017 based on the figures in that tax budget. And as you can see, if you look to the very far right, it has each year's difference. And with the general fund, it's kind of been all over the place. It's been in the red, in the black, in the red, and then happy to say that in 2016 and in 2017, we will be back in the black with the general fund, which is a good thing. It's a direct result of very conservative spending as a result of the actual general fund in those departments, as well as the transfers made out to streets and parks. So that conservative spending has allowed us to remain in the black or be in the black in 2016 and even more so in 2017 if all goes well. And then at the end of each major fund section, I have what our suggested minimum reserve is. And at the end of 2017, we'll almost have double in reserves for the general fund that we need, which is based off of, I base these off of 4 months worth of operating, even though the standard is 3 months. So the general fund is gonna be in the black for the next 2 years, thankfully. If we look down at the electric fund, There's a pretty big deficit in 2016. That's a direct result of $500,000 that was transferred out into the capital improvement fund. We've also got some capital expenditures in 2017 that are digging into those reserves a little bit, but the reserves will end up at the end of 2017 in a more normal range. The suggested minimum is 1.4. almost 1.5, and that's where we will be at the end of 2017 as well.
Where are those big capital costs going?
There's the
the poles.
Yes, the poles and such. So I know that Johnny had bumped some of those things up just to try to speed up some of the repairs that need to be done in the electric fund.
And I believe there are also some repairs to the switching station that need to be completed as well.
The electric fund is an interesting fund in which to try to predict because we do have our power costs, which are kind of a moving target at times. I do get a projection from AMP, but there are so many variables that are that have to be taken into consideration that it really is kind of a moving target, and it just needs to be watched on a monthly basis in order to really figure out what's coming down the pike. And with all of the hydro plants that are coming on and have came on at a very staggered rate, that also kind of complicates things a little bit. So the electric fund, it is kind of an interesting one in which to try to budget because it can be very difficult at times.
So you're saying because the energy costs are going up and down, you don't need, it's hard to predict ahead of time.
It is hard, and it's really hard to try to predict the revenues for the electric fund as well, because I can look at what we've been bringing in, and I can take the rate increase into consideration as well. But we also have a power cost adjustment that we collect, which fluctuates every single month. So it's a really hard fund to try to predict what's going to happen with it. So it just needs to be, that's the one that has to be constantly revised, because it's the most dynamic of all of the funds. If we take a look at water, 15, we were in the black. 16, we will continue to be in the black, as well as 17. The rate increases are a direct result of that. That's another one that we have to, you know, keep an eye on, just because we want to see those reserves be built up as a result of the rate increases, so that we can afford those loan payments once those come on in 2018. So water fund is on the upswing, as it should be with the rate increases. If we take a look at the sewer, again, in the black and the red, and then back in the black again, which is good. We've got the rate increases that are there as well, and allowing those reserves to be built up a little bit, which is good too, because we can start to be able to move some of those reserves into capital improvement funds, which we haven't been able to do until this year, which was the most modest of transfers. We were only able to move $25,000 into the sewer capital improvement fund, but as these reserves are being built up, we're going to be able to support that improvement fund for future improvements much more so. So that one's looking much healthier. And then the solid waste operating fund, just because it's an enterprise fund, I included that in there. Really, it should be what we're paying, you know, what we're bringing in should be what we're paying out. We want to make sure that we've got enough sitting, so that, you know, if everybody decided to stop paying for their garbage, we would be able to still support that bill that comes in for 3 to 4 months. So those are the fund balance histories, which is going to be important in considering the budget as we move forward with the actual formal 2017 budget here in another 2 months. And then I've got the capital budget too, which 2017 ties to what I folded into the tax budget, with the exception of one item, which came out of the water fund. We've got $1 million earmarked for remote water meters. With the building of the new plant, it only makes sense that the 50-year-old water meters are replaced, so that we're able to accurately capture the revenues that the water plant needs in order to be able to pay for itself. A lot of people believe that when a meter goes bad, it will speed up and thus charge them more, but in reality, it's quite the opposite. If a meter is old, it will do nothing but slow down. So that means if the meter is slowing down, then it's not accurately capturing the revenue. So I did not include that in the tax budget before you, as it's going to be a loan, and we're still trying to work on firm numbers for what those remote water meters are going to cost. And until we've got those firm numbers, I just left it out for now, but it would be a loan that we would take out.
When were you thinking of putting them in?
2017. Because it's going to be a large project. Water meters are much more difficult to put in than what electric meters are, because most of them are in pits or inside people's houses. As to where the electric meters are on the outsides, most of them are on the outsides of structures, so they were able to get in without disturbing anybody and do it much more efficiently than, you know, removing them from a pit or having to get inside somebody's utility closet and coordinate with them. So we were wanting to start that in 2017. That way, when the water plant was up and running, we've got all new water meters in, and they're going to be efficient. So those are the documents in front of you: the tax budget, the major fund balance history, and then the capital budget.
I think it's pretty obvious how well we're looking financially, since Melissa's been, and Patty also, and staff has been very conscientious of their expenditures at Patty's request. So and I think Melissa presents us with information that's easy to understand and very clear, so we really appreciate that. Any comments, any other questions from council?
Just want to add my thanks to Melissa and Patty for their hard work.
Any comments or questions from citizens? Kate.
Katie Anderson. Where is the Safe Routes to School money standing in all of this right now?
Melissa is running that project, so I'll let her answer that.
Safe Routes to School, it's actually in the 2017-2018 fiscal year for the for Ohio Department of Transportation. We are doing everything on our part within the time frames that they have allotted us. So that's where it currently stands. Now, if we can get everything done ahead of schedule, they might bump us into the 2016-2017 year, which starts July 1st. So we're doing everything that we can in order to get things accomplished and staying on track, but it's requiring the use of consultants and expertise outside of the village, so we're kind of at their mercy in terms of getting everything done.
Why don't you tell them where with the two consultants exactly where we stand right now?
They're working on all of the right-of-way acquisition right now for where the sidewalks are going to go. So they are, I get regular updates, and they are working very diligently. So I don't know if they will end up ahead of schedule when this is all over and done with, because the consultants just started probably about 2 or 3 months ago. So it's quite a bit of work.
Yeah, I'm aware. are the numbers staying close to the last numbers that I saw? Are we ahead of the game, or I'm trying to read.
I can answer that.
Okay.
The village is not going to have to put any money into this now. ODOT has actually come up with some additional funding, and they're going to go from the crosswalk there at Fair Acres on Fairfield Yellow Springs over and down all the way to meet the existing sidewalk on Winter Street, and then ODOT's going to do that whole part on their dime. And then the village is going to, we have committed to extending the sidewalk from where they're beginning to Stafford Street so that it's not a sidewalk to nowhere.
Okay. Do you have any awareness that there will be extra money left at the end of this?
I doubt it. If there is, they're going to keep it because they're putting extra into the project.
Yeah.
And okay. We did ask them if there would be any hope of doing anything else, and they were like, no.
The reason I'm asking is because one of the bigger things on our action plan for Safe Routes to School was crosswalk markings.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so one time, I believe recently, I think I heard you say, Patty, that there might the acquisition, the right-of-way acquisitions were coming in lower, and there might be extra money around.
Mm-hmm.
So I would like to say that if that occurs, to see some of these markings, those crosswalk markings at the schools be taken care of. They don't cost that much. No. The village is already going to do it when they do 68, so
mm-hmm.
I'm putting that out there publicly because that was a really important piece.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kate.
All right, thanks.
Anyone else? Okay. I guess we do have to take a vote on this. Is this a resolution?
Yes.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay. Now is the time in the agenda when we hear from citizens about items that are not on the agenda. Each citizen has 3 minutes. We ask that you come to the podium and speak and state your name. Chrissy?
Hi, I'm Chrissy Cruz. First, I want to thank Council for their decision a year or so ago to pay for the trash cans downtown to be covered with the nice pottery. I think they're so beautiful, and I see so many tourists stop and look at them, and people comment on them, and I know that there was some flack about how much it costs to have those cans done up like that, but they're beautiful, and I really appreciate it, and I appreciate that Council went forward with that project.
And can I just add to that, also, two-thirds of that project was sponsored by individuals, businesses, mm-hmm. and the community foundation. Mm-hmm. So
it was well worth it. You don't see those anyplace else, and so often I see people stop and talking about them, taking pictures of them, and some of them, like, this is my favorite, the one in front of Tom's with all the dogs on it, and everything. It's really cute. But then I have a concern, which is that I noticed that in the streetscape, the signs for 2-hour parking limit have not been reposted on Xenia Avenue. and I don't want to point out anybody, but I know a lot of shop owners or people that work downtown that park right on Xenia Avenue, and we have very limited parking there. And being a person who has problems with my legs and my back, you know, I see frequently somebody that parks for days in a spot that's right in front of Tom's, basically. And I wonder why the signs haven't been put back. And then two of the police officers told me that even when the signs were up, all of the officers don't enforce. So then if you don't have all the officers paying attention and enforcing that, then people feel like they've been singled out and picked on. Mm-hmm. But I do think it's important for the shop owners downtown, parking is so limited, that people who work downtown or set up and sell things downtown, they shouldn't take up parking space for days and days. So that's my citizen's concern.
Thanks, Chrissy. Anyone else? Beth?
I'm Beth Bridgman, and I'd like to read aloud the letter for the record that I sent earlier today. To members of Village Council, I write this letter to add to the discussion of the abuse of power by some members of the Yellow Springs Police Force. While our unfortunate encounter was not as heinous as the two incidents described in recent news media, abuse is abuse, and our incident demonstrates a pattern of overreach by other officers on the force as well. Our son graduated from Yellow Springs High School on Thursday, May 26. Late that evening, after festivities were over at the high school, my husband and I had a very small celebration party at our home. At 10:30 p.m., my son's girlfriend, an Antioch student, remembered that she had not taken an antibiotic that she was supposed to have taken at dinner time, so my son drove her back to campus to get the medication. They pulled into the Horseshoe at 10:40 p.m., where my son saw a police officer doing what he thought was helping a car parked in front of South Hall. He later learned that Officer Charles was ticketing that car's owner for parking in a fire lane. As a faculty member myself who works at Antioch College in South Hall, I know that all of us often temporarily park with our hazard lights on during off hours while we run into the building to pick something up. It is common practice, and as it turns out, it was indeed an Antioch College staff member who had come back to campus at 10:30 to get something from her office. She came out to find she'd been ticketed. Our son and his girlfriend proceeded around the Horseshoe, where he pulled into a parked space in front of North Hall and waited in the car while his girlfriend ran upstairs for her medication. He admits it was a lapse of judgment, but the parking space he pulled into was a handicap space, one of the three handicap spaces that exist there, and there are two non-handicap spaces there. All three handicap spaces were empty. It was 10:45 p.m. The campus was quiet. There were no other cars or people in the area. Officer Charles pulled around the Horseshoe and gave him a $250 ticket just before his girlfriend returned to the car. All of this in less than 5 minutes. When my son tried to apologize for his lapse of judgment and explain the situation, he was continuously cut off by Officer Charles. He finally gave up trying to speak. Because we have our own campus security officers at Antioch College, we were all confused as to why the Yellow Springs police were even on the Antioch campus at 10:45 at night. The next day, my son and I spoke with Roger Stoppa, head of our campus security, to tell him what had happened, as we were confused. He expressed surprise that my son would have been ticketed instead of given a warning and asked to move along, since he was sitting in the car. He said that during his days as a police officer, he didn't ticket someone sitting in a car in a situation like that. He just gave them a warning and asked them to move along. Roger Stoppa called Chief Hale to explain the situation. Chief Hale said our son would have to go to mayor's court, but that he suspected there might be a lesser fine or even the possibility of dropping the charge, according to what Roger said to us. At mayor's court 2 weeks later, the mayor upheld the charge and our son had to pay $250. During the same mayor's court, an Antioch student, a senior, one of my students, she's a biomed major, just getting ready to graduate and move home, had the exact same charge my son did. She had been studying for finals and at 1 a.m. had pulled into one of the three empty handicap spaces in front of North Hall. Again, there are two regular spaces there and three handicap spaces, to grab a bagel and to come right back out. She, too, at 1 in the morning on an empty Antioch College campus, was given a $250 ticket for parking in a handicapped space. This was the money she was going to use to get home after graduation. The mayor also upheld her charges in full. And I'm just going to say here, nice haul for the village, $500 in profit in 5 minutes from two students under the age of 22. Students on the campus of Antioch already have a tremendous amount of distrust for the police. Many of them are active in the Black Lives Matter movement and are hyper aware of injustices and abuse of power. Officer Charles' overreach in these three campus incidents do no favor to the view of the police force among members of our Antioch community. We are so grateful for Roger Stoppa and our campus security team who practice community policing, making it their duty to get to know the community, establishing a sense of trust, and thereby engendering a mutual two-way respect. It is a wonderful thing to watch. Roger reminds me of Chief Grody and his team, many of whom grew up here and knew the community, who were so very good at community policing. The current police force would do themselves as well as the village a tremendous favor by working to repair the damage they have done to their image and to establish the practice of respectful community policing. A $250 charge to an 18-year-old saving for college for parking in a handicapped space for 5 minutes at 10:45 p.m. on an empty college campus, never leaving the car, with two adjacent and empty handicapped spaces available, was an enormous amount of money for a small lapse in judgment that affected no one. It left a very bitter taste in his mouth, one that will not soon be forgotten. Respectfully, Beth Bridgman.
Thank you, Beth. Any other citizen concerns?
The letter was not submitted previously, but there's 7 copies.
Thank you.
I'm Ken Odior, and I'm a native and long-time resident, presently not residing in the village, but property owner and taxpayer. I call upon the village council to act decisively to change police department policy, practice, and police department administration. It is painfully clear from recent inappropriate use of force incidents by a Yellow Springs police officer that the department has either failed to establish control of its officers or that the attitude, policies, training, and acceptable methods of the department are not suitable for our community or any community ruled by law. I applaud the council's decision to end the village's participation in the ACE task force and the council's moves to engage the community to improve the relationship between the police and the community it serves. From my vantage point, however, council should need no more public input nor time to observe that the department has lost the legitimacy of its command. Our community deserves better, and there are late reports that better policing is being developed and delivered elsewhere. I call upon the council to replace Police Chief Hale, appoint an interim chief, and place a permanent chief by year's end. We have all watched with horror and disgust the video evidence of police stops showing inappropriate and excessive force, sometimes ending in tragic, needless loss of life and shattered families. Appalled and outraged, we see that the officers and the superiors involved are, with few exceptions, absolved of criminal or administrative penalty and returned to their posts. Since one of our citizens lost his life after summoning police for help almost 3 years ago, we have searched, studied, and taken measured but limited action. Now we must admit that the best efforts and attention have not been sufficient to reverse the national trend toward military methods in our own town. I'm not unsympathetic to the difficulties of policing, nor the special challenges presented by our particular population. Nor am I unaware of the dedication, professionalism, and uncommon intelligence displayed by many duty officers on our force over the years and in the present time. The critically needed and indispensable trust generated by the fine work of some members of the police department is being squandered by the actions of a small number of others. Meanwhile, the enthusiasm and cooperative spirit of those in the community and on the force are not inexhaustible. Our council must rule. I implore you to engage a sufficiently wide section of the community to vet and select a capable leader for our police department as soon as possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Any other citizen comments?
I'll be brief. My name is Bill Farrar. I'm a villager.
Could you spell your last name?
F as in Frank, A-R-R-A-R.
Thank you.
I think we've been here 12 years, although I'm fuzzy on the math. I'm a father to three adult children and married to a lovely person. As such, we are also a respite spot for numerous young adults and sometimes teenagers who spend an afternoon, an evening, or a couple of weeks benefiting from our home. To echo those things that were recently said about our police force, I'm here unelected and unappointed by those folks to let you know that the police are not seen as a resource at all. They are not seen as someone to call for help. It is very clear to me that rape avoidance has been done by young citizens who are not calling the cops. Don't call the cops is the first thing that gets said. Violence avoidance is being done by young citizens who say, don't call the cops, don't call the cops. It's ineffective. It's terribly ineffective. It's not vigilante, it's survival. It's not an unwise decision. I'm telling them, don't call the cops. I'm the white, middle-class, middle-aged, privileged man who gets to afford to live in Yellow Springs, and I'm saying, don't call the cops, not even the good guy. It's a big issue. This sort of urgency, I think, metaphorically, please treat it like a flood. Half of your town is underwater. Act now. Do it now. Make this your number one priority. Do not table this conversation. Do not let it go. Act on the things that have been presented. Make it better. The council has some resource here. You are elected. You're appointed. You are who we asked to represent us. Please do. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes.
Melissa Tinker, Yellow Springs. I'm also calling to register my concerns about excessive aggressive tactics on our police force. In particular, most recently, I have been very concerned about reports over what happened on Memorial Day weekend. I live right downtown, and so from our house, sometimes we're woken up by people fighting when the bars get let out. Have been seeing things that appear to be domestic violence, and I feel that at this point I would think really hard about calling the police to intervene because of the recent incidents that have come to all of our attention. So I don't really have an answer, but I'm here to show myself as a very concerned citizen. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. So there were certainly a lot of concerns expressed. Later, I think I may turn to Judith or Marianne if they want to say anything, but I want to say a few things first. I mean, we really have prioritized policing policy, justice policy, and we are working tonight. One of the items on the agenda is in reference to our justice system task force that we have been talking about, and Marianne and Judith have taken on, and the rest of council have committed to. When we're talking about policy that impacts the entire village, we're talking about laws, we're talking about a lot of things, so it isn't a discussion that can happen quickly. I believe it will be deliberative, and that we will move as quickly as we can. Council, by charter, which is our constitution, cannot hire and fire anybody except this person and the person at the end of the table and our solicitor. So that is not the pleasure of council. I look to our village manager for those decisions, and I know that she is doing a good job at working with our staff and communicating with our staff. I know that there was some discussion. I don't know if I do have one more thing I do want to say before I turn it over either to Patty or to Chris, that an officer was relieved of duty today, and that would be Officer Whittemore. I know that that's been a concern. The situation with Antioch College, Chris, was Chris going to address that related to village policing of Antioch College?
I believe Chris was going to address part of it. I did want to let everyone know that Chief Hale is actually scheduled a lunch tomorrow with Roger Stappa to start talking to him about the police presence on the campus. Roger does support the police presence on the campus. I have that in a previous email, but I'll let Chris address campus security versus police force and see what he says.
It's my understanding that, well, first of all, Antioch is a private university, and they have a private security, as I guess is the best way to describe it. They are not deputized, which means they do not have any authority to enforce any local ordinance or state statute. By way of comparison, state schools, Miami, Ohio State, they actually have deputized police officers who have full authority within the territorial limits of the school area, and oftentimes due to a mutual aid agreements, that authority extends beyond what might ordinarily be considered the school. In the last few years, another example would be the University of Dayton and the city of Dayton. I went to UD, my dad taught there for years, so I have an understanding of how campus police have evolved there. For years there was a distrust between the city and how campus police functioned, and in the context of sexual assaults, that was a big issue because when local matters were investigated by the school police, there was a concern that maybe they weren't thoroughly done. So in Dayton, I know that they have expanded because of mutual aid, where Dayton police officers, University of Dayton police officers, actually now patrol that entire campus area. They conduct traffic stops, enforcement of DUI laws, etc., that involve more than just the students. So in the context of the patrolling authority within Antioch University, even though it's private property, that would be left to the Yellow Springs Police Department because of the limitations on the power that Antioch security would have. I think that the first step to resolve these issues and to get a clear understanding is going to start with the chief meeting with the gentleman, I guess Mr. Stappa, and to discuss that. That's the big overview, and I think that as you discussed, I think this is a matter that you're the Justice Council can take up as well in the context of the overall scheme of things. But that's about all I have to say, unless there's any questions from Council.
Judith or Marianne, did you want to reference anything in regard to the Justice System Task Force?
I would like to say that tonight, a little later in the agenda, Marianne and I have interviewed several people who have put their names forward for the Justice System Task Force. And I think the role of the Justice System Task Force here in Yellow Springs is one where we're looking at how do we strengthen two important institutions in our village, the police department and the mayor's court. We've seen a lot nationally discussed about policing in our society and our country, the militarization of police, which is in part, I think, a response to the huge amount of guns in our society. But I feel like we as citizens, you know, it's a responsibility of the whole society to respond to the problems that we're seeing in the policing that's happening in this country and in our community. It's just not the police. It's a whole society that has kind of allowed this direction of policing, this militarization of policing, to go on for many years. And it's the whole society who's going to solve the problem with our police departments. And so I feel like we're hearing about a breakdown of a relationship which we have, I think, the whole of the village government, our police department, village council, and I haven't discussed it directly with the mayor, but the mayor, I'm sure, is concerned about repairing these relationships. And the strengthening that we're talking about is not, you know, warrior strength, but more the strengthening those relationships of trust, where the police are seen as servants, public servants, where they see themselves as public servants, as guardians of the safety of our community members and of visitors as well. And so we're starting that process, and we're making recommendations tonight, and I'm very hopeful that it's really the first that council has said we feel it's important that council be involved in thinking about our policing policy. It's the first time it's happened, and I think it can lead to some very positive results. So
thanks, Judith.
I think I also want to highlight a more immediate initiative that we talked about at our last meeting, our last two meetings, is working on, I guess for lack of a better term, community sensitivity training. And we've talked with the chief, we've talked with Patty. I know Bob Baldwin brought this up, as well as others, at a meeting. And that's something that John Gudgel and Village Mediation is prepared to develop and work on. And so that is something that we want to implement right away.
Thank you. Just briefly, yeah, come up to the microphone, please, Bob.
A few short remarks. I think the community and the council and the police force is probably primed to investigate the concept sweeping the country of community policing. For years I've heard the medical profession say, do no harm. I think community policing says, assess the situation, take whatever action is required to do no harm. That does not mean community policing is easy on crime, but it means you do not jump to conclusions without assaying the situation. Is there some harm? Is there some danger? Can this be resolved in a satisfactory manner? In other words, can policing still end up as a win-win situation? I think it can. I think everybody in this room is interested in this concept called community policing. It's going to take a while to really wring it out, but it's the coming thing. It makes sense. We all know the police department has to be part of the community. That's one of the big concepts of community policing. I think this community is ready for this concept.
Thanks, Bob. Okay, do we see any other comments? We'll move on. We still have a pretty full agenda. Thank you all. So next is the draft RFP for municipal fiber installation. Patty has prepared a lot of information for our packet.
At the last meeting, council asked myself and the fiber advisory board to come up with a draft RFP including certain things that council asked for, one being the feasibility study, including a detailed take rate and some various funding options, The business plan, including a marketing strategy and a preliminary engineering study, including the make ready for the polls. To that end, I was sent an RFP that was used by Hudson, Ohio. Dan actually gathered that amongst several other documents. I took that to the first fiber advisory board meeting, and we started working on reworking that proposal to meet the needs of the Village of Yellow Springs. What is in your packet tonight is a rough first draft of that, so that council can look through it, make some suggestions as to what else you want to see. If there's something in there you don't necessarily think we need, we can take it out. I do have a potential timeline in there. That timeline is fluid. I simply put in the dates based on the fact that council felt they wanted to move forward relatively quickly with this next stage. So at this time, if council has any thoughts or questions, we can go over those things.
Maybe I'll start.
Okay.
So I saw a reference that says the village does not own any fiber optic infrastructure. So we don't own the backbone that's connected to the Bryan Center, any part of that?
Thor Sage actually did that section. So if he says we don't own it, then I'm going to say we don't own it.
Okay. Because I would be curious then, because, you know, we have the connection to the schools.
Correct.
Okay.
And I actually asked Thor to redo that section on the details of the existing fiber network resources, so that it would be accurate.
Okay. Yeah, it seems to me that it would be helpful for them to know at least that those main, so what we've got a connection to Maveca, we've got a connection to the high school.
Right, and what will happen is when the people answer this RFP, they'll have the opportunity to ask those kinds of questions. And so then those answers will be posted for everyone who responds to the RFP, so that they can include it in their proposal.
Okay. There was a reference to excess capacity with the college and someplace else. And I wonder, Greenan. Is that?
The Greenan Local School District and Antioch College.
So Greenan Local School District is connected?
Okay. I think that's Maveca. I mean, I'm guessing that Thor wrote that,
yeah,
correct?
Thor wrote that entire section.
Okay. So I guess what I'm wondering is, I know there was talk about dark fiber connected to Antioch University, and I also wonder about the Yellow Springs schools.
I can ask Thor about that.
Okay. Governance and ownership strategy. I was curious about what the intent of the reference to private sector partnership there, just what
there are several different ways to to do this, and the assumption was that it wouldn't hurt as far as in the RFP to have them look at all the different types of ownership. And then council can make the decision on which way you want to proceed before you write the actual RFP for the fiber network. And so the thought was, let them provide us with all these different options. And then if council still chooses to go with the full ownership route, that's certainly a possibility, but you'll have the funding scenarios in front of you.
Okay. So I would suggest that maybe that section does clarify that we're looking, you know, kind of a comparison to all the options, because what made me pause there is that it only focuses on private sector participation. Now I understand what you said, which means that we want to be prepared to look at that, but just to be clear that that's not the only option we're looking at.
Okay.
And then my last one was about infrastructure recommendations. And I highlighted owned by the village. Oh, okay. So I guess I just wondered, because their prior reference says we don't own any fiber infrastructure. So I guess this would be once we, if we did.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Right, right.
Okay.
That's, yes.
Cool.
Judith or Marianne?
Nope.
So it gets,
it sounds like, I mean, given the schedule that Patty has put before us, I would say that we will need to have this RFP. We'll have legislation for this at the next meeting. Is that the intent?
Yeah, we have actually another Fiber Advisory Board meeting tomorrow night, and I scheduled it deliberately so that we could continue working on this with whatever council brought tonight.
I guess the only question I did have is the schedule a little too tight?
I don't think it is. I actually based it on the Hudson schedule and made it a little bit looser than what they had. And I've also neglected to send out, there is actually a 94-page report that Hudson got as a result of putting this out. So if anyone wants to actually see that 94-page report and wade through it, I'm happy to send it to you.
And that was the response?
Yes, they had several responses ranging anywhere from $0 to $250,000. They settled on Magellan Advisors at, I believe he said, $58,000, and they ended up with a 94-page report from Magellan outlining all the different things they had asked for in their RFP.
Yeah, I mean, let's keep it aggressive. They'll wait to the last minute to do it anyway, so whatever the end date, whatever the end date is when they'll write the proposal, so.
So any other comments or questions?
I just wanted to express appreciation for, I guess, you, Patty, for, you know, getting this together so quickly, and so we can figure out whether this is a realistic goal or not.
Comments or questions from citizens? Okay, we'll move on. So
you have, excellent work.
Yes, go ahead.
It's coming on to 9, and we started at 6.
Oh, do you want to take a break?
I'm thinking at some point soon it would be good to have a break. I don't know if you want to do it now.
What's next on the agenda? Let's finish old business, and then we'll do it after, unless there's an emergency.
I don't know.
I don't mean to pry.
Emergency.
To stand up.
So the next item on the agenda is a discussion of swearing in of members of boards and commissions. I think that was something that had been talked about at one point, and something that Marianne and had referenced in relationship to some upcoming, especially the Justice System Task Force. So I guess I see it as a relatively short discussion item about whether that is something that council is interested in doing with our boards and commissions.
Well, I think actually Judy was the one who brought up the idea, I think.
Yep. Okay.
And we also found out it's common practice with a lot of municipalities.
It seems like that it's a way for council to actually meet people that are going to be on commissions,
right,
for the public to meet, to be able to see who it is, and to make it a more formal and recognized position.
Sounds good. So I think, are we done with the discussion? So
well, I mean,
it would be the same, is it the same swearing in, or Chris would write something? Chris, will you provide us with something, language?
I think it makes sense, since they're subcommittee of the council, for you to swear them in. I'd just like to say as well.
I can get it for free. Want something quick and easy.
And then how would it work? So we'd ideally have them come to the meeting where they're being nominated, but...
Well, that's a question, because they're being nominated, and I mean, we ran into this. I wrote up these three little letters, which I didn't understand they were going to get in the packet, but they did. And Judy pointed out that, tonight, Judith and I are going to be putting forth names in nomination. But until council approves that, it's not a
right
deal.
It seems that, and I guess the question would be, do they have to, you know, we're asking them to come to a council meeting, you know, should it be done at their own meeting? Are we going to go back and swear in existing members?
Well, if you do it at their meetings, then that would mean the council to meet them.
Yeah.
Right, would have
I
to
would
go
be
to
for having it be at our meeting, maybe a month after they're, you know, chosen, And, you know, if there's people that can't make it, you know, then it could be done
right
privately.
Or, I mean, let's just say at the next meeting, you know, if they would come to the next, whatever the next meeting is after the nomination
right.
is accepted.
But it could be any meeting, right? So if they can't make it to that meeting,
yeah.
right?
So we're not holding anything in particular in abeyance until they're sworn in. I mean, we're not.
Right.
Okay. I mean, so, we're not holding their participation.
And I also know what some municipalities do is, I mean, they pick a day every month to do swearing in.
Yeah.
But I sort of like the idea of we do it at a meeting and ideally the next meeting, but if not, as soon as you can.
So they can get there.
I rather like the idea of doing it when you do your board and commission, that meeting.
The second meeting of the month.
Yeah, second meeting of the month.
Yeah.
And then
okay.
if they're, maybe do announcements and swearing in and that becomes just a standard part of the
that
agenda.
Could be.
You don't
maybe
have
even just have it
very
in.
Often, but
right.
yeah.
Okay.
In terms of Mary Ann's letters, form letters, which can be, you know, added to or whatever, I thought it was a nice idea, and I thought she did a nice job to just give us a tool for council members when they make their nominations and the person is chosen and that it, the letter go out electronically.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
The only thing I'd caution is that when folks apply, generally I will let them know, you know, a recommendation will be made, council will vote on the position, then we'll let you know, what the outcome of that is. And my only caveat with one of the letters made it sort of assume that, and then you will be, it sort of assumed you would in fact then receive that position. And
so we might need to, it might need to be
just need to tweak it a little bit as yeah. it's a multi-step process because you don't want to disrespect your own process.
Right.
I mean, of voting on that nomination, so.
Okay. Well, when I made up these letters, I thought that it would be a way to let people know before it came to council, instead of finding out when it comes to council, oh, well, they accepted I'm going to be on or, oh, I'm not going to be on. But.
Or whether you're going to be nominated, you mean?
No, whether you're going to be on. In other words, if person A and person B apply for something, and we are going to nominate A and we're not going to nominate B, I thought it's sort of nice for people to know ahead of time. But given that it's not
so they could come and advocate for themselves if
no.
we didn't recommend them.
No, maybe. I just thought it was nice good. To let people know.
I think it's a great idea about, you know, what the
but I guess it has to, we can't, they can't assume that even though we're going to nominate them that they're going to be on. I mean,
right. And maybe you'll be limited in.
I didn't think any of them said that, though.
Well, it, after your nomination has been officially approved, maybe it should say if your nomination or expecting, should your nomination or expecting your nomination, something to at least give them some grain that this, there is a possibility that you won't
well,
be accepted.
I'll go over these wordings.
Okay.
And
yeah, no, I think
I
this
actually
is,
haven't gotten together yet
yeah.
to talk about all this.
And I think this is great. I think I like this direction, so I think it's good. And
yep.
I like Judy's suggestion of the second meeting. Let's keep that with commission boards and commissions.
And then I'd also like to add, I think that's a great time for the roles and responsibilities statement to be prepared for signing.
Okay.
Because I think that slips through the cracks sometimes.
Okay, so are we done with this topic?
When are we making our recommendations?
Let's take a break. Let's take a break and then we'll.
Under new business.
Under new business, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Okay.
Where did it go?
We'll take a 7 minute break.
Go.
Seven
that's
minutes.
Our, that's officially our.
That's officially, so we'll.
That's what we said.
Let me get 7 minutes.
Yes, we're
hey, Judy, you ready? You, Susan?
Yeah, about the training.
Rolling.
I know we talked about it here at the meeting. And
we're back in session. Please take your seats if you're staying. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is a policy discussion regarding village special funding. This is an I prepared
I don't know, a report, I don't know if I'd call it a report, just a document that explained the way I thought we had discussed at the retreat, looking at and considering some of our expenditures. I think what I was talking about at the retreat was a little bit more related to our general, looking at our overall expenditures and making sure people understand and that we're explaining when we repave a road that we're actually helping economic development. It's going toward economic development, and just kind of identifying how all of our expenditures are being impacted or are impacted by our values. This specific document relates to nonprofit organizations and basically kind of community quality of life types of things. So staff had talked about wanting to bring a proposal to council related specifically to fees that would be charged for events and other kinds of things that the village is involved in. As far as I know, I think it was just events. One of the things we had talked about at the retreat was that we actually make expenditures that benefit nonprofits and other organizations, all other kinds of expenditures. We just did a sponsorship of for Arts Council. We did sponsorship for the silent auction. There are a number of events that we support. We have an $8,000 budget, I believe, for projects that are funded by the Human Relations Commission. We have the John Bryan Youth Center, the meeting rooms. So there's any number of ways that we provide support to nonprofits and community kind of quality of life. So rather than picking out one of those elements of just events, I felt it would be good for us to articulate a policy and look at how these expenditures are made and articulate a policy so that when one organization comes to us, we can say, okay, this meets this particular value, and yes, we will contribute, or we will sponsor, or we will be involved for that reason. So it feels like there's some questions in the community as to some of our expenditures, even some questions on some of the things we've done, the pool water for the Antioch College Wellness Center, and tap fee waivers, and the infrastructure's improvements, and the land sale that we've done with Home Inc. So I think that having a value proposition as to why we're making those expenditures and what those expenditures say about supporting what particular value and what particular goal we're supporting, it helps us better articulate why we're making that particular decision, why we're making that particular expenditure. So also I think, I know that one concern of staff is, some of these things come out of their individual budgets. So maybe rather than them coming out of their individual budgets, that we have a separate line item for that would basically, it would be a council budget line item for either, just as we do for HRC, maybe it's for nonprofit donations, whatever we end up calling it. I know that Patty and I have been struggling with what are we even calling this. I said village, I think we ended up with village special funding. That seems like an umbrella that kind of describes things that are beneficial to the community but not necessarily required.
I have a question. When it's coming out of individual budgets, what sort of things are, I'm not quite sure what you're talking about. Is it like the police department or something like that?
Man hours for special events and things like that come uh-huh. out of the individual departmental budgets.
Like the PD, say for?
The PD, the electric, the water, the sewer, the streets.
Parks.
Parks. It just depends on what the event is, uh-huh. where it comes from.
Oh. Are you done talking about
yeah.
it? One thing I noticed on value three, at one point, and maybe it got dropped off when you guys edited it, changed it a little bit, but there had been the being a welcoming community abilities had been
oh,
one
you're
of
right.
the listed it, things that was missing there.
Do you know where?
I think it was at the end, I think it was just cultures, incomes, and abilities, rest.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cultures and what?
And this is gone, and then it's.
Oh, okay. So Karen, were you envisioning like some kind of general document that said the Village of Yellow Springs seeks to support quality of life, blah, 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 and does this by this way, this way, this way, and in order to, if you want to apply for funding or something, these are the criteria that you have
to meet. Well, there is an actual document that council has, and in fact, it's in your packet, should be in your packet tonight for the Arts and Culture Commission.
Oh.
Yeah, and it's the one that, and it's the one that the Arts Council used and to come to land.
Right.
Yeah.
So there right. is, for funding that is strictly from council's budget, that is the form that is used.
Yeah.
The question is whether you want to use that for everything
sort of
else.
Say, this is why we're doing it.
Right.
Kind of
right.
Thing.
But I think I think also the point is that I don't see that funding as being different from events. Events are supporting nonprofits. That kind of form, giving money to.
Let me do a search for an answer.
Is that me? I'm so sorry. Jeez, I don't know why that turns on for no reason. Sponsoring, giving money to Arts Council for their member show is sponsoring a nonprofit. So it's supporting nonprofits. To me, there's no difference between the support we show for an event, the in-kind support we provide for an event, and giving money. And and that's my thing was, why are we separating the discussion into two different topics? Why aren't we looking at it holistically?
So if we were to do that, then like if Antioch College wants us to put up their signs for graduation or whatever,
right.
they would Mm-hmm. They'd have to fill out a form and.
Well, we'd decide, I guess. We'd decide if that's, I guess that's part of what.
So if staff got a letter saying, we'd like a tap, or if you could.
Right.
Drop the cost of this or that. But it would it, so I know street fair was one of those sorts of things, so would that mean. We've been doing it for years. These things that we've been doing
right,
for
right.
hundreds of years, that would it back up, and so then a form would have to be filled out.
Well, there is a form. There is a rental agreement for the Bryan Center, not for the rest of. There used to be a parade permit, but at some point that got dropped, or a street
closure
yeah.
permit. Yeah, there's a special event form that is available through my office, and all of the things that are listed under special events here, like the zombie walk and the street so fair and the parades. So we would be asking people to fill out this form. They now. Fill those forms oh, out. Oh, they do. And, uh-huh. and they uh-huh. give them to us, and we go over them at a staff meeting and see what we have to do.
What we need to do.
But that's not the same as requesting
well,
support.
But what Karen is saying is that the manpower that would go into that for putting up barricades or snow fencing or police escort, that's what she's saying it should all
be considered the same as
sure.
these other donations. I'm not saying it should be. I'm saying I think it should be at least talked about how
so
we're differentiating between support, how we're supporting different.
Yeah, I appreciated your paper. But I'm just trying to sort of think about how would that work. For instance, going back to the zombie walk, they fill out a form, an event form.
Mm-hmm.
Staff figures out what it's going to need for resources or whatever.
Right.
Then does it come to council and council decides whether to do it or not? What we're trying to do with the events right now is come up with an hourly rate per person, so we've taken the departments that are involved in all of these events, like the police department, the public works departments, both all of them, and we're trying to come up with an average per hour rate, and then we also have a number of hours that each of the events averages out to take us. So things like the Simply Women 5K takes a little more time than, say, the MLK parade, because the only thing we have to do with that is the police department leading and following the end. Mm-hmm. But they take less time than, say, Cyclops Fest, where we have to do something a little bit more in depth.
Would it then come to council as, are we going to do this or not?
Well, I mean,
it's going to cost this, and are we going to donate it, or are they going to partly pay it, or something?
Right. That's what Karen is thinking. I mean, staff was originally just looking for something more like, you get the first 2 hours gratis, and then it's XYZ after that, prorated somehow, or something like that, a standard policy. But if you're going to include it in this, something like this, then you may not want to do that if you're going to put them all together. So.
Yeah, I mean, so personally, I think that it does make sense. I mean, we've got a form that I think can be improved, and actually Judy, I think, already worked on putting the village values and the goals on the back of that form that's been used. So I thought that was a good starting point. I like the idea of an introduction as well about, I mean, I think all municipalities to some extent support events, not just for nonprofits, but for economic development. And so I feel like we've got a process in place. And then the question is, you know, if somebody's asking the village to sponsor it, it would be an additional request. But maybe they wouldn't, right? I mean, it may just be a special event, and then we've got the standard, and they may be able to fund it.
I guess I'm trying to figure out what is, it feels a little bureaucratic to me, like it could become kind of bureaucratic, like that we're doing so many of these events. That's mm-hmm. my only, so that's just a first thought. It feels a little bit like, would it have to come to council then every time?
Well, and my only concern about that is that some of them do kind of wait till the last minute. Uh-huh. So, but I don't think that it would necessarily be a problem except for in August when we only have one meeting.
But also isn't the issue of whether we're going to charge and how we're going to charge.
Correct.
And how we're going to decide how we're going to charge.
Correct.
That's the most difficult, whether or not it's all under one umbrella or not.
I mean, what it brings to mind is how much the staff does to make all these millions of little things happen. I mean, I really didn't think about it that much, but there's a lot of little pieces, a lot of little events that are constantly happening in the village. And
and depending, like I said, depending on the event, it could take more time. And for instance, Brian's talking about banners, and you know, some events have one banner or two banners, and some events have 30 banners. And so that's when the one or two isn't necessarily a problem, but when you start hanging 30, it's, you know, a little bit more time consuming. So
I almost feel like we're going to need a little time to think about it, mm-hmm. just in terms of process. I don't know.
Well, I think this was Karen's goal, was just to frame the discussion.
Uh-huh.
And I mean, because we had said that on at the July 18th meeting that we were going to have a discussion of just the cost of special events, mm-hmm. A proposal from the village related to recouping the cost of special events. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I guess we could have that, you know, we could have that discussion that way. I was just proposing that we frame it a different way, because to me, pulling out special events from other things we do just does seem it seems that there's some inequity there.
The idea of having a separate line item I think is worth pursuing, though, as I look at some of these things, like say Perry League and baseball and youth center, not everything may fit in one line item, but at least pulling it out so that we have a sense of how much money is going into that is worthwhile. Yeah.
One of the concerns that Melissa has is that for the special events, if that came out of a special council line, because that's more payroll related, mm. that may create a bookkeeping issue downstairs.
Mm.
you would have to charge people out of department, and that can be really confusing.
Oh, yeah.
Who was working for their actual department that day, and who was working, you know, for just a portion of the day.
We don't want to make things more difficult.
The payroll part would complicate things quite a bit.
That's my concern.
So, just another piece of the puzzle.
Yeah.
And I thought that there was a pretty big distinction between what you wrote for this meeting and then the other side, which is looking at the sort of four ways of dividing up how the village spends the village money.
Right. But that, I think all of those could apply. All of those could apply to the investments we make in events and everything else. I mean, I think that there's certainly an argument to be made that events are economic development activities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what?
So they're a positive for the village.
Right.
Well, but they're a positive if they contribute to the quality of life. They're a positive for the village, too.
I think it's worth drawing people's attention to the fact that, you know, it might make be a good thing that people haven't really realized. You know, it's more than just a quality of life. It actually brings financial
well-being. I mean, in a lot of these things, I mean, when I look at Karen's list, I mean, they hit all the village values, different ones. I mean, you know, the work we've done at the library affects the carbon footprint value. I think it's interesting that, you know, we can really align those two things, and I think we have made good decisions about why, you know, it's not just frivolous by any means.
And if I can just jump in a little bit, when I polled other communities as to how they funded events or asked or charged for various events, many, many of them had a festival of some sort that they either flat out charged for or counted as this is economic development straightforward and it is funded by our community. And it sort of fell along either line. It almost seems as if for some of the items, they may want to be broken out into what is our economic development policy. What do we want that to look like with regard to some of these larger events, which do bring in a significant amount of revenue? Is that something we want to fund, as opposed to things like just the smaller events that take a smaller amount of time, and perhaps those become percentages of or fall into different categories and are looked at differently? I mean, I just see you guys going, oh my Lord, there's a vast array of a spectrum here, and how do we, you know, address that with one fell swoop? And I don't know that you can. Throwing that out there.
So the next meeting, we're going to have another discussion?
Well, our hope as a staff is to have the information on the special events ready for council.
Yeah, that'd be great.
I mean, that was our starting point. So as far as the special events, that's our goal, is to have that in the packets for the next meeting for the 18th. The rest of these items that Karen's talking about, as far as the water lines and the streetscape and those kind of things, that might take a little bit more time to get all that together, because I know Melissa was trying to work on that. But she had a tax budget to do.
And part of the purpose of this is to be using this information when we're looking at our own budget, correct? Wasn't what we're partly thinking of it as a budget.
Well, and you know, we're talking about council and commission budgets. Are we going? You know, we're getting into the budget cycle. Are we going to give money to other commissions besides HRC? I mean, we had talked at our retreat about a much broader discussion, I thought, and so that we could have some justification for why are we waiving home inks tap fees and selling them land at half price and extending infrastructure. You know, that is different than we typically do for residential development. We're doing it because we want affordable housing. We're doing it because it meets a value of the village. That's why we're doing that. And if we can identify, it doesn't make everybody happy, but at least we have that justification. I think if there are other things that we do. I mean, the elephant in the room for me is that street fair is a big piece of this, and I can't, you know, anything I say related to that, I can't. And in fact, I'm going to talk to Chris. I may have to recuse myself from the discussion, from the next meeting discussion. So, but it's not just street fair. It's all of the other events that I see benefiting nonprofits and, you know, benefiting businesses and other organizations. So, you know, that's the difficulty for me, and my position would be that there are other ways to look at these, and, you know, is there a justification for, you know, when staff brings a proposal or brings something about, I guess what council will then have to discuss is, do we need to do this? You know, we've got a pretty healthy looking budget. Is this the time that we need to start adding on expenses to the community, you know, charging the community for things that they haven't been charged for in the past?
I do think ultimately the most important thing is whatever information we're looking at, that it's contextualized. So, I mean, that we are thinking about these values and goals. That's, I guess, what's important to me in this discussion. So,
and I could see having a statement, and sort of some of the things you've said on this page could be in a statement saying that the village does more than provide the basic services of water, sewer, blah, 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 and that it does these things for these reasons, and that it works with, at times, groups and individuals to provide these things. I mean, some kind of statement. I mean, we're always going to have to end up having to make decisions about things. We're not going to be able to get out of that.
Right.
But at least there could be an overarching statement that says these are the kind of things that we do, and we do them because we have these particular values.
And it will help us make decisions, too, if organizations are coming to us, you know, thinking about it in that way. Not to get into the weeds, but it occurs to me, I mean, maybe if there are sort of things that are about using our space that maybe don't require labor, that could be, you know, in this budget that Karen was talking about that might be, a council line item. And then if we know there are certain events that we decide as a village we are sponsoring, those could be factored into those particular departments. I mean, you know, we could figure out the number of hours. So I guess I don't think it's going to be that complicated. And I would like to streamline it, you know, at least into, you know, one form. And then maybe there are, you know, a couple budgetary things to look at.
Okay. Judith and or Mary Ann, the recommendations on the Justice System Task Force?
Well, I'll just read my report out, I guess. So just to say, Mary Ann and I talked to several people. There's been a lot of interest in the Justice System Task Force. We were very impressed with the skills, knowledge, and commitment to our community shown by the citizens who applied to serve on the task force. And we want to thank all the applicants for being part of the process, spending time in conversation with us regarding the importance of our local justice system, the police department, and the mayor's court, and ideas regarding how to strengthen these important institutions. The following people applied for membership on the task force: Basim Blunt, Jennifer Berman, Laura Curlis, Patricia DeWeese, Kate Hamilton, John Hempfling, Ellis Jacobs, Steve McQueen, Scott Osterholm, Jeff Reich, Aaron Sari, Al Schluter, Dave Turner, and Mary White. Nia Stewart, a high school junior, has also applied. She left for an international trip before we were able to interview her. We wanted to have representation from our youth in the village. And she has a friend who also, the two of them want to participate. Her friend is a student that's actually from outside of town. We're thinking of, you know, there would be one person who would be a member, but this other young person would be participating as well. In considering whom to nominate to the task force, we considered applicants' skills and knowledge as well as connections to various groups in town. We want the task force to reflect the diversity of our community. We are nominating the following people and two alternates. We are recommending that I be the council liaison, and that Mary Ann be the alternate. Our nominations are Jennifer Berman, Basim Blunt, Patricia DeWeese, Kate Hamilton, John Hempfling, Ellis Jacobs, and Steve McQueen. We're going to ask Jennifer Berman to be she would be the liaison to the Village Mediation Program, and Kate Hamilton has been chosen to be the liaison of the Human Relations Commission. We wanted to nominate two alternates, Al Schluter and Dave Turner. We wish to encourage those who are not chosen as members of the task force to participate in the meetings, share their wisdom regarding this important community work, and you know, we definitely saw people as resources who we didn't end up choosing just because of wanting to have that that important mix that would represent the villagers.
And just to be clear, all of the meetings will be public meetings.
All the meetings will be public.
And
we have told people who apply that we would start the work in September.
And Jennifer Berman also works at Antioch College.
She also works.
Is there some thinking there too?
Jennifer Berman, in terms of some of the specifics, Jennifer Berman is in charge of the restorative justice program at Antioch College. And one of the, you know, things that one of the concepts that we would like to be looking at is this notion of restorative justice. She's also active in the mediation program in Dayton. And we talked to John Gudgel, the mediation program here saw her as, you know, a resource that would, because we had talked about a liaison to our mediation program, and he thought that would work very well. Yeah, Basim Blunt works at WISO. He also has strong connections with the students of Antioch College, and he heads up a youth program on WISO, where youth are telling their stories or probably not giving it justice. I mean, everybody had their strengths, if you want me to go through them, but
no, that's okay. I was concerned about Antioch.
Yes,
not concerned.
Yes.
I just wanted to clarify representation
yes,
from the college.
Yeah.
I just want to say that Kate Hamilton must have been extremely strong because she's listed twice.
She was listed twice. That's what happens when you're writing a document from your smartphone that you can't hardly see. So, yeah, she accidentally got on there twice.
So,
I don't know. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, everyone we interviewed had some really good ideas, and I've tried to document those ideas so they don't get lost. So I think we were very impressed already that there have been a number of ideas, and I think, as Judith said, one of the ideas that I think both of us were struck with was the concept of the police department as the guardian, as opposed to warrior, as guardians of the community. And apparently there are some police departments across the country that are trying to use that image as the center for developing that culture. But so this group represents people from teens through their 70s, African American presence, gay presence, gender balance, and a lot of diverse skill sets and backgrounds.
Okay. So are you looking, you're nominating tonight? Is that what you're hoping to do?
Yes, we're nominating those people. Well, I'm not, I guess we should have a second on it.
I was going to say, did you make the motion?
I make the motion that we.
Any more discussion?
Nope.
Have we made a nomination?
Yes, so those are the nominations. And there needs to be a second.
I'll second.
Okay. Any other discussion? Any comments from citizens? Okay, seeing and hearing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. And I just do want to iterate what has been said. These meetings will be public. Everyone is encouraged to attend. There will probably be working groups, And some of those working groups could well have people that are not on the task force who could be part of the working group. So it needs to be pretty well embedded in the community, I think, to be effective.
Thank you. Good job. Mary Ann, other commission member nominations?
Yes. So Catherine Hitchcock has left HRC as of, I guess, our last meeting. And there had been some people who had expressed interest in being on our HRC for the past year. And so we interviewed three people, Jessica Thomas, Lindsay Burke, and Scott Osterholm. Scott is currently on HRC as an alternate. And so Brian and I interviewed these three candidates. And what we are recommending, we nominate Jessica Thomas to be the regular HRC member. And we feel both her youth, she represents racial diversity and brings a lot of skill sets and energy and enthusiasm. And we are recommending that Lindsay Burke be assigned as an alternate and Scott would continue as an alternate. That is our recommendation.
Is that a motion?
So I make that motion.
Second.
Any further discussion?
Again, I just want to emphasize, from my perspective, an alternate is a member of a commission, and you know, rarely do commissions vote. So, you know, I think it was a challenging decision. Three very qualified candidates, and I hope all of them actively participate on HRC.
Okay. Comments? Okay, seeing and hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
And then we added the agenda item of the CBE property and what to do now. Chris, could you give us a little timeline of, I guess, you know.
Do you want Melissa to explain the grant as well? Once Chris is done with the
sure,
timeline.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Who's going first?
You.
Okay. My comments are pretty simple. In order to facilitate the transfer of the property, I think we just need to do a termination agreement of the existing agreement. It'll take about, I think, 60 days. We want to make sure that the legal description and the deed are proper, maybe get some title insurance, but the process itself is simply drafting the agreement and then getting it before council and approving it by resolution. So conceptually, it's not complicated.
When you say the termination of the existing agreement, do you mean the loan that they have with?
Well, let me get my copy.
The village.
There was a development agreement that was signed in 2003, and then it was amended at least twice. And so that would, the termination agreement would include any documents that were entered into over the years, which would include promissory notes, the amendments that were made to the original development agreement. So, you know, just gathering that information and making sure that we've buttoned everything down. I would expect that CR would, if they haven't done it already, would pass a resolution to formalize that in some reflection of their minutes, which is a technical piece, in the same way that a council would adopt the resolution to approve that the manager enter into the agreement to accept the transfer of the property, and then we would have to record the documents. So there would be deed preparation and other things. But I mean, I don't anticipate that there's anything going to be complex about the process, but I say that knocking on wood because I don't know what I'm going to find yet.
Okay. Any questions from council?
No questions.
Thank you.
From me.
So, Melissa, go
ahead.
I
was going to say something, but I'll wait.
Yeah, go ahead and talk about the. Yeah.
Basically, there is a grant that is still hanging out there with the Army Corps of Engineers that's been been there for quite a while, and the accounting was in need of some attention when I first started, and so Denise Swinger and I had started to look at the grant and the accounting that was done to try to clean it up to figure out what was left, because the fund was in a negative status. It was brought to my attention during the audit, in the 2013 audit when I first started, that existed, so that needed to be cleaned up. And we discovered that in cleaning that up, that the original agreement was that the Army Corps would support 75% of the costs for the water and sewer infrastructure at that property that we're discussing currently. And it was to make sure that, or it was to run utilities all throughout that property. So obviously, kind of the shift of the plan has kind of been shifted, and we were looking at how we could get reimbursed for what we'd already spent in engineering. And so also along that process, it was discussed that we would possibly reduce the scope so that we could still be able to take advantage of that grant. And what the reduced scope would do is run the utilities from East Enon Road at that intersection up to the turn lane to nowhere, for lack of a better description. So basically, at the end of the day, we spent $130,000 in engineering costs that we had yet to get reimbursed for. And with the reduction in scope and the changing of the agreement with the Army Corps of Engineers, which we are very close to getting done, at the end of the day, we would be able to extend the utilities from East Enon Road to the turn lane to nowhere, the water and sewer infrastructure. And it would actually result in the village coming back with $12,000 more than what we have right now. So the cost of construction would be $260,000. And the check that would be written to the village, should those construction costs cost to the penny what the estimated cost would be, we would get a check for $272,000. So basically, the village would be $12,000 ahead, and we would have utilities ran to that stretch, being able to make that property ready for a developer to come in and do what they may with it, or whatever else we decide to do with it.
And Patty, could you address a time frame, potentially, how you see this all happening?
Once the scope is reduced, the construction project is a pretty simple, straightforward. It's right in the right of way. There's nothing really in the way there. So it's, you know, by the time you let the contract and then award it, I'm going to say 4 months tops, depending on whether or not the construction company is tied up doing other projects. The actual construction itself shouldn't take more than a month, 6 weeks, something like that. So it's probably less than 4 months, but I would say that if we decide that we're going to pass the resolution and reduce the scope of the grant, that it can be done by the end of the year if council decides to move forward.
Okay. And we've already spent, what did you say?
$130,000 back a long time ago. More like the 2010 to 2012 time frame, which we were never reimbursed for. The grant just kind of laid dead because the accounting, I mean, there were so many changes in personnel that, I mean, basically we spent that money in, I mean, we got engineering out of it, but we didn't really get any end product out of it. So this is really big, because we're going to be able to maximize that grant funding and utilize those dollars that we already spent towards our match, and actually be able to get an end product from this and actually be $12,000 ahead than what we are today.
Oh, okay.
And we did have the engineering estimate updated. Mm-hmm. For the reduced scope. So
we're not going to get reimbursed for the 130, but it's considered the match.
It's going to go towards our match.
Yeah. They don't have to reimburse us for that. They don't have to give us any credit for that.
Because we're reducing the scope.
Mm-hmm. So, but they're going to do that.
I'm confused. So it's good, I feel like it's good that the Community Resources made the decision to give the land to the village. Mm-hmm. Village put in $300,000 mm-hmm. of revolving loan fund money, and you're telling me the land is probably worth $600,000 now.
According to the updated appraisal.
Right. 650.
Okay. So there's a decision that needs to be made about whether we want to go forward with extending utilities.
Well, I believe that and you were in this meeting, so correct me if I'm wrong, because I wasn't. But I believe that the appraisal on the land was done assuming that the infrastructure would be to the turn lane to nowhere. Mm-hmm. So if we don't do that, you have to assume that there's going to be a slightly lesser value. Mm-hmm.
And it has to be done this year?
It doesn't have to be done this year, but
in order to keep the...
They haven't stated that in those words, but this grant has been hanging out here for a very long period of time, that they are feeling pressure to tie up
either
a lot of these older grants. And so we've been really trying to work hard to at least get this to a point where, you know, a decision can be made whether or not we want to move forward or not.
If a grant is on the Army Corps books for longer than 5 years, they start feeling pressure from the government to put that money, give that money back if it's not going to be utilized, or allot it to another project.
I mean, it just seems to me, as Patty said, that the appraisal was based upon the getting that infrastructure there, and it's so it's obviously increasing the value of the property. It doesn't tie us into anything other than getting the infrastructure there, which interestingly enough had never been included in any of the estimates for the CBE anyway. That wasn't, I don't think that was included in the original project.
Yeah, that was it was stormwater.
This is stormwater, water, and sewer. Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, to me, it's, and again, you know, tonight we don't, you know, we still don't, this is still a step process. These are two different things. I mean, certainly the first thing we have to talk about is, you know, releasing Chris to work with CR on getting these documents, doing everything we need to do to get this transfer to happen, which will probably happen over the next 60 days. So,
I know that there, as we all know, that this was a very controversial project, mm-hmm. which didn't happen because of that. So I guess my question is, why wouldn't we extend the...
Well, I think it's important to note the reduction in scope. That's the big difference between what was proposed before and this. I mean, this project is completely in the right-of-way, doesn't go onto the property itself, prepares the property to be a little bit more viable to a developer, whomever that may be. You know, it doesn't tie in with roads here and there. It does help that we are getting back the ownership of the property as an entire parcel, as opposed to just owning the roadways.
My question is, why wouldn't we do this? And I'm asking that because since this was a very controversial project, and we have probably a couple people who are here because of that, maybe, I don't know, that I just wanted to sort of get a heads up about what would be the arguments.
The argument is to not develop it, is to not develop that property. That's the only argument against extending those utilities. As Melissa said, it is not going to cost the village anything. So
we're going to actually get $12,000 back.
So this is an ideal situation where we get that infrastructure taken there. There is nothing for which that infrastructure won't be beneficial other than literally not developing those 40 acres. Let's open it up for discussion. Dawn?
I have a question. When will we be able to see the reduced scope?
The reduced scope, the actual agreement, Chris, that's about ready, right?
I've approved it. There's a form. The money's correct. So we're ready to present to council.
OK. Okay, so we, Melissa can ask the Army Corps if we can include that in the next packet.
But when we say reduce scope, we mean that we're just extending the utilities.
From the intersection to...
That's what we're talking about.
Correct.
And I mean, we've got a map, and we've got the estimates, and we've got what's already been spent, and we've got the total project, and, I mean, we've got all this mapped out. I mean, I've literally been working on this for over 2 years.
But that...
At least the, you know, the old grant accounting and everything that was spent and making sure that it was Army Corps money and not ODOT money, because there were, you know, two different grants with that. Well, OPWC too. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
It's water, stormwater and sewer.
Correct.
Well, excuse me. I will say a lot of that money is being actively pulled back. I mean, from what I've heard in the last 6 months. So I do think...
We'll have to make a decision.
Yeah.
Any other citizen comments, questions? Okay. So are we hearing to release Chris to work on the property transfer?
I think that's a good idea. Yep. And if we can have that information in the packet,
from the Army Corps for the scope.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Next item, we added the Arts and Culture Commission request. Brian?
So I thought it was important to at least discuss this tonight, because I guess it is time sensitive in the sense that the Arts and Culture Commission is talking about, and so the project is the Yellow Springs Selfie Spot. I guess the ideal would be that this project would be viable this summer. And so that's why the Arts and Culture Commission wanted us to discuss it as soon as possible. One thing that I think is interesting is in our discussion about funding of commissions, that the Arts and Culture Commission actually decided to use this forum. I mean, it wasn't something that I suggested, but they decided, they knew about the forum. John Fleming, our chair, talked to Patty, and you will see that, I mean, the visual is not what it would actually look like. This would be graphically designed, which is what the $300 request is about. And the Arts and Culture Commission highlighted a village value, which is being a welcoming community, as well as our goal about an economic development strategy. So the argument being that this will bring attention to the village, this will you know, add yet another fun thing for people to do, and Tom Gray, who owns Tom's Market, has already agreed to it. So anyway, so I know that the Arts and Culture Commission is interested in getting a response sooner rather than later. So
I have a question. What's the Heaven on Earth mannequin on that?
You haven't seen the mannequin?
She sits in the chair.
Right in front of the YS News when you walk back there. Yeah.
Yes.
So
I'm sure Diane has many selfies.
Yeah, so she's decorated for Independence Day and all that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Whose is that?
Heaven on Earth.
Yeah. And you do see a lot of people taking pictures with it. I mean, it's...
Yeah, I don't want to know what's happened to that poor woman.
Well, I'm not real excited about this thing, I have to say. I don't really think that it meets either of those values. I don't think that, I mean, being a welcoming community, I think, is about people reaching out and being community, and I don't think that this, for me, qualifies that, and I really can't believe that it would make much of an impact on economic development. But I guess mostly it feels sort of not Disney World-ish, sort of. I mean, it just sort of, anyway, it's not that appealing to me. Now, if the Arts and Culture Commission had a budget and then they wanted to spend it on this, then that would be up to them, I guess. But
I'm raining
on their parade.
Well, I think ultimately, though, I mean, for any of our commissions, I mean, we should be fairly explicit about what those budgets should be spent on. I mean, it's still council's budget, right? And so, I think that's something that's important to me across the board.
But in this, it sounds like this is just a temporary thing?
Yeah.
Potentially, I mean, it's a short term.
I think the idea was to keep it up through Labor Day weekend.
Oh, so it's just a summer thing, okay.
And then probably pull it back out next summer. All right, so I think we have a couple options. first of all, I liked the idea that the form was used and in moving towards this idea of how we make these decisions. But as I also mentioned, I guess the sort of folks in particular that, are the, creators or innovators of this are not here tonight, but could be here at the next meeting. That might be an option similar to what we did with the Tecumseh Land Trust request.
Mm-hmm.
We asked for more information. Maybe that's a good way to do it, is to discuss it more the next time. But mostly I wanted to at least kind of bring this up because I think it's in line with our overarching discussion.
Can the whole thing be a little bit more about Yellow Springs? I mean, I don't know, just Yellow Springs' most interesting person doesn't sound particularly interesting to me. maybe it could be, and the fact that this is just showing the sign and not showing what the final art is going to look like isn't helping. But, I mean, maybe come back with something a little bit more firm and maybe something that relates a little bit more strongly to Yellow Springs.
If part of the idea is to be about the welcoming community, then I don't know if there's something.
Some wording that's
something that could actually say something about our values about a welcoming
mm-hmm.
community, something
yeah.
like that, that could actually make people be thinking.
Maybe we could have real live Yellow Springers there.
selfies with Elfies. That's what this.
Right. Yeah, I think that's good feedback. The Arts and Culture Commission meets before our next meeting, so.
I mean, because there are so many issues around lack of inclusion in and so if there's something about this little thing that actually is a statement about about inclusion.
Or maybe it is even about not just trying to get somebody to do a self, bring a friend to do a selfie or something,
ask a passerby.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, grabbing somebody in a friendly way.
who's this person? I don't know them, but they were walking by.
My new friend, I don't know,
right.
Something.
Yeah, well, I think that's good feedback. I'll take it.
It
back to the commission. Really, I mean, I just kind of am here to share what their ideas were, so.
Very good, thanks. Moving on to managers, assistant manager, and clerk report.
Mine is pretty straightforward and simple. You see there the results of all the lead and copper sampling for 2016 in the village. We did have two actionable sites, which means that they had levels over that were higher than detectable. They were notified per the EPA and offered retesting. I believe that one of them has been told they want testing, or they are able to have it retested, but have not contacted us back. And I believe the other house is currently vacant, so we're trying to track down. The letter came back, and we're trying to track down the current owner of the property so that we can let them know the results as well.
Okay.
If nothing else, we can put a notice on the door to service that. And the other thing that I wanted to let council know is that we are going to be converting just the back portion of the dance room here outside my office into an office because Jason Hamby will be coming back over to the Bryan Center He's currently out at Sutton Farm. We did check with all the groups that use that room, and they say they will be, still be able to use that space effectively, even if we take that back portion for an office. So we'll just be erecting basically a wall that cuts the back part of it off. And
so what is it, about a third of the room?
It's probably a little bit less than that. It's it's, if you look on the floor, there's an outlet on the floor towards the back, and it'll be on the, whatever that way is, west side of that outlet.
Okay.
So it'll include the first two windows, but it won't be much past that. And then we'll create the yoga folks use a closet, so we'll create a new closet for them in the room so that they can still have that. And then we'll move Jason into there.
What happened to his space?
We're just trying to consolidate everybody back here that we can. The only one who won't be here is Brad, and Brad is required by EPA standard to be at each of the plants for 20 hours a week, so having him here would not be practical. So we're just trying to consolidate the staff to enhance the communication a little bit.
Patty, the sites that were chosen for the water testing, mm-hmm. were they linked with the places in the village that we know have lead?
They have to meet certain criteria. If the house was built before a certain date, you have to have lead solder on your pipes. If it was built after a certain date, you have to have lead pipes. The EPA sends out some very stringent guidelines as to how you choose your sites. And we actually had a couple of sites that dropped out this year, and we had to find new sites to meet the criteria and had quite a time doing that. I think Judy's house is one that we regularly test. So it's the older houses that have the lead solder or the lead pipes.
But I meant we have connections, the village has, remember what they call
right,
those,
we,
some
the,
kind of connections?
Yeah, the little Crow. Chicken leg thing.
Oh,
yeah.
Chicken foot.
Yeah, we actually test ours at different points throughout the system.
Oh.
So, I mean, we're okay with.
So this would be, those results would be household problems,
household
not
problems.
Village.
That's correct. Those are household issues.
And on the house that is uninhabited and you're mm-hmm. having a little bit of difficulty, I mean, I think the thing would be to make sure that somebody doesn't move in there. You know,
right.
If it's a rental or something,
right.
that mm-hmm. that there's some kind of notification.
Right, Brad is working on that, yes.
Melissa? Thanks, Patty.
Just two big things. The utility office window will be expanding its hours. We have two full-time clerks that work 7:30 to 3:30, and the window was only open 10 to 2, and it's always been like that. I'm not really sure how those hours were set originally, but they've always been that way. So we've heard concerns about the request for extended hours, so they will have hours from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. Monday through Friday. That gives them enough time to get it going when they get there at 7:30 and to shut it down before they leave at 3:30. And their hours also coincide with the public works staff that they have to work very closely with. If there's ever an issue with, you know, meters or, you know, the distribution system or the electric or anything like that, they rely on those staff to assist them. So their hours are in line with theirs, so 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. Monday through Friday, and then on the 15th of each month, as usual, they stay open until 6 o'clock. But anybody can call between the hours of 7:30 a.m. and 3:30 p.m. to have their questions answered.
And what day, if the 15th is on a weekend, which day would that be?
If it's on Saturday, they'll stay open late on Friday. If it's on a Sunday, then they will stay open late on Monday.
Okay.
Or same thing with a holiday, if it falls on a holiday.
Okay.
And then the long-awaited process of reading water meters on a monthly basis is starting this month. So everyone's bill, August 1st, will have a monthly read. There's been a lot of confusion over the numbers that are on people's bills. They've always been quarterly reads, so the number that you see on your bill is for 3 months' worth of usage, whereas as of the bill that is going to be received in the mail August 1st, the number that you see will be 1 month's worth of usage, which was always the common misconception with the quarterly bills. So if it says 3,000 gallons, that's what you used in a month. And I'd also like to throw out there, just because I've seen that a lot of people thought that their reads were really high. The average is 2,000 to 4,000 gallons per person per month. So if you have a family of four, you might have a $12,000 or a 12,000 gallon water bill, and that's perfectly normal. So just thought I'd throw that out there.
Okay.
That's it.
And thank you so much. I mean, the extended hours are great. It was, I think it's good for us to provide that customer service, so thank you for that. And I know you have been fielding a lot of questions and a lot of concerns in the office, and so give thanks to your staff and thanks to you for fielding all that.
Will do. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And, do you want to say something about the budget?
Yeah, I meant to say something at the end of the tax budget. I have the proposed 2017 budget schedule in the packet. I bumped it up a meeting from what we've done in the past just because I was taking it up to the second meeting in December, which was giving me, you know, up until the wire since it has to be submitted by January 1st. But I backed it up a meeting so that it would be finished by the first meeting in December this time. That way, if, you know, something came up, I've got a one meeting buffer in there. And plus, it's nice to have it done right before the holiday hits. So I bumped it up one meeting.
Okay, sounds good. Does this look good for everyone? Good.
Question?
Sure, Bob.
Will there be a graph on that water bill? It's really helpful. I get one from Green County Water Department, and it's got a little graph. You use this much, it shows what you used last month. It really helps a landlord and a water user keep track of what the heck's going on in his plumbing. But the graph I have found very helpful, but if it's an additional expense or you can't do it, I don't understand it.
It's already on there.
Oh, it is?
Yep, okay. Yep, all we've right. Got the graph on there.
Okay.
And it sounds also, could you speak just a little bit about this, your new the new software, and when that will be happening?
Yeah, we had a demo last Thursday of a new utility billing software, and it's got capabilities that are just leaps and bounds above what we've got now. So right now, we need to work with the new IT firm in order to determine, you know, our server, the server requirements that are necessary in order to be able to run the software, and if we need to make any adjustments to bring us up to speed, because we all already know that our servers are dinosaurs at this point. Mm-hmm. So this might just provoke us to be a little bit quicker on replacing those servers. But the reporting, if you've ever had to come into the office and get your history from us, it's really hard to read. I literally will stand with a customer and highlight different colors depending on your bill and your pay and penalties if they're in there, and they're just really hard for the average person to be able to look at. So the reporting capabilities are just so much better. I mean, you could print out somebody's history and it's easy to read. It's, you know, got logos on. I mean, we can format reports and give people information that we can't right now, and I'm really excited about that.
That's great. Thank you. Marcia.
Just a question. So the number of gallons on our bill, like in the past, was for the quarter?
It was 3 months worth of usage.
And
yep.
And it will be in the future, starting when?
1 month. August 1st will be everybody's bill August 1st that they get in the mail will be 1 month's worth of usage. We've had to phase it in. So if your account started with a one or a two, you've already been switched to the monthly cycle. So the account numbers that started with a three, they were the last ones, but August 1st, that bill, everybody will have 1 month's worth of usage.
And the blue that was spray-painted on all our sewer covers, our water covers in my neighborhood.
What neighborhood? I'm not sure. Somebody else called us and asked us about that.
Water? Mine have been blue for, no, there. It's yeah, it's actually on the water. Mine have been blue for a long time, so.
No, we just got a flag up. So we put a little blue flag up and spray-painted the.
Honestly, couldn't tell you. Have to ask John.
Yeah, that's a John Maroon question.
Could you maybe ask and
yeah, we'll have to ask
get
John
in touch with.
Yeah, I have Marcia's email, so if you'll remind me to get with John.
It's all. It's my name. I'm holding a little blue flag, blue, and spray painted blue on top.
Yeah, they did that to mine late last fall, and I knew they did it, but I never asked why. To be honestly,
I'm not sure.
Not sure.
Okay. Oh, Judy, clerk's report. What?
Nothing.
Business
as usual.
Nothing.
Yeah.
Future agenda items, our next meeting is July 18th. Funding of commissions, discussion regarding distribution of proceeds from sale of village land, village special funding. I don't know if we want to take that on more, right, we've got the resolution, or the ordinance for Morris Bean.
CB.
It sounds like we won't have anything for the CBE by the next meeting.
He wanted information on your Army Corps.
Army Corps, yeah.
Right, that's.
Well, the H piece, the Army Corps piece might be ready.
Mm-hmm, right.
But the transfer piece will not.
The RF.
RFQ, yeah.
So your resolution, or you want?
Yeah.
Resolution regarding the RFQ?
RFP, is it RFP? Fiber, okay. So how are we going to talk about these?
Sorry.
I mean, we've got three things here. This discussion regarding distribution of proceeds from sale of village land. Do we have any more information on that?
I have an estimate. If council remembers, I broached the subject of potentially using, at that time, some of the funds from the sale of Sutton Farm to build new crew quarters for the crew. We do have an estimate on that, and it will unfortunately probably take all of the money from the sale of the land, and maybe a little more. We also have the problem of, we had our inspection by the Public Entities Pool of Ohio, which is our liability insurance carrier, who said that we definitely had to do something because we don't have decontamination showers out there right now. We don't have laundry facilities, which you're supposed to have for folks who work in chemicals and sewers. And they really didn't like the water running underneath the walls during the rain.
So that discussion, I mean, there is a discussion about new crew quarters. I mean, I'm not sure, why aren't we just talking about that during the budget?
Because we can, but we had broached it as a possible use of some of the money from the sale of the Sutton Farm to put back into the Sutton Farm. What needs to be done, whether it's funded through that or through this year? I would like to start the process this year, because this is something that obviously can't be built until next year at this point. We have a blueprint that was developed several years ago when this came before council and they needed new crew quarters then, and it never got built. So we still have that same plan, and that's what we're trying to get the estimates off of. So.
I guess we also need to add swearing in, and maybe that could be associated with announcements. So do we do it at the beginning?
Yeah.
Yeah. And maybe that just becomes a standard part of our agendas, in case we have any. We may not.
So, okay. So on this discussion, are we going to talk about funding of commissions? Or are we going to hold off on that?
I thought you had wanted Patty to bring specifics. Is that the next step that you want to?
Specifics on event.
Special funds, yeah, special event funding, but not on commissions.
I know we discussed using that land sale. Obviously, we need to do something about the quarters for the staff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But it somehow complicates that. It feels like it complicates that discussion, trying to think. I don't see why we would use that.
Well, I mean, the other option is, council talked about putting part of it into green space and part of it back into the general fund. You could do that and just take the money for the crew quarters out of the general fund,
yeah,
if that's what you choose to do. It was just something that we thought, if you're going to,
because the land's out there, it's kind of
correct,
connected.
Yeah.
So
it doesn't matter as long as the crew quarters get built.
Right. So how do we want to? Okay, let's not leave the. So we're just going to have village special event funding discussion. Is that
special funding? Yeah.
Well,
or you want it to be just specifically the event?
That's what I thought you said you were going to bring.
I'm confused. Would be prepared to bring.
Well, right, but I think we're still having a policy discussion Right.
And I was going to.
That's the context, and then.
I was going to assign dollar figures to the list, too.
Right.
Oh, that list on there?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that wasn't intended to be
no?
a specific list. No,
okay.
I mean, that was just.
It's
yeah, I mean,
samples, examples.
Just examples. I mean, it wasn't specifically intended to be something that you were going to specifically
okay.
put numbers to those. I mean, I guess it's the kind of thing, I don't know if I want you to, you know, I mean, council has to decide if we even want to approach it that way. I don't know if we've decided that. Okay, so we know we've got the resolution.
Well, I was going to say, if you are not going to be able to lead that discussion, then I think Brian should prepare to.
Right.
And maybe have something in the packet sort of about how to.
Well, and I'll talk to Chris about, you know, if we can separate it into two separate discussions or how exactly it's going to go, how it can go.
I
well, if you want to do events separate from other things, then it can be two separate discussions. But
I mean, I think, or maybe it's a two-part discussion, but it occurs to me that, and I'll think more about this policy framework, but starting to have numbers and examples will inform that, right? And we don't have to make a decision right away about events, but that can start to tie into that.
And if it is a two-part discussion, then I could leave part of it and stay for part of it. So are we going to have a discussion about funding of commissions? Or just move that to budget?
I think if you leave it for too late, you're going to get into your budget process and not have a decision made.
I think it's part of special funding.
Okay, so we'll
so
just.
So I think it's.
So let's just say village special funding.
A discussion.
I don't,
not a decision.
I don't see it as special funding. It's actually, to me, I don't see it that way at all. Human Relations Commission is a commission, a council. It's not a nonprofit. You know, it's not the same thing as a nonprofit.
But what it's funding, but I think what they're funding, what they're giving money to, there's a lot of discretion, and you know they're not taking the money. It's not money for their function to meet or to do whatever. It's money that they're giving.
Well, their money is being used for the wealth, the welcoming community, that value and goal of council. But I mean, we can talk about the commissions as a whole, not just HRC, but to me, it's not the same thing as a nonprofit in the village that does wonderful things for the village, that are towards the goals of the village, and that we may play a role with, but it's just a different relationship.
But HRC is giving money to some of those nonprofits, so I don't know how you can separate that. It's the exact same thing.
So we're not thinking about funding of HRC. We're thinking about what they're funding for.
Now, aren't we going to talk about funding for commissions?
Yeah, I think we should talk about funding for commissions.
Is that what we're talking
about?
But
I think it's a different, we have to think about it in a different way.
It might be different, but the way I see it in the same vein is that it's about our values and goals. So, I mean, that to me is sort of the common thread for all these things. Is the reason why we have established that HRC budget is because of the value you mentioned. The reason why the Energy Board would come to us for funding would be the carbon footprint.
Yep.
That's
the reason we set up some of these commissions, honestly, was to meet those.
Right.
Right.
And facilitate
yeah.
that.
And should there be funding given to some of the other commissions?
Yeah.
And you know, the issue is that this money is not. I foresee as being used as grants, just the way the money for HRC is being used. HRC is basically giving out grants. Those grants could be coming through us, and just like the request from TLT came to us.
Why don't we have the discussion when we have the discussion?
Right, I agree. I'm trying to decide what is. We're trying to come up with what is the discussion going to be, and what needs to be prepared.
Right.
Well, I'm assuming it's not just going to be one discussion,
right.
Because we will need to go back to all the commissions and talk to them about what they would need money for. So this is just sort of overarching.
Mm-hmm. Well, but you can start that conversation this month because it's early enough in the month that everybody's going to have a meeting.
I would just suggest if we want to discuss both of those questions, that the commissions be kind of a separate part of the discussion, just because they're.
Okay.
You think they're unique in their relationship to village government. They're a part of village government. So I just, that's the reason.
Yeah, I agree that we'll parse them out, but I do think there's the core, like, concept that maybe they're all related to. Like, why are we doing any of this?
Everything's all related to everything else.
That's very good, see? All right. So we just need one agenda item.
We're all related.
It's getting late.
Okay, yes, okay.
It's the guy is here.
So I will entertain a motion for adjournment.
I move that we adjourn.
And I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.